What's up, everybody? Welcome to Chef Shock, the shockingly real, shockingly live, and of course, shockingly delicious cooking show. I don't know if you heard, but Nintendo updated Animal Crossing today, which really makes me happy. You can see I got my chef clothes on. Let's check out my house. I really want you to see it. I'm really proud of it. I guess I should start cooking soon too, but I don't know. It's my show, so I just told them I'm gonna do what I want today. Like, oh boy, something just happened. Hey George, thanks for subscribing. I gotta give a lot of shout outs because last night's stream was so epic. First off, we were on the front page, which is nuts. Check out my gingerbread theme. Gotta love that, right? My whole house is edible. What was the update, Andromeda 5? The update was that we got a campsite where you can car camp and get random stuff. I haven't fully explored it yet. I'm actually just doing it now, and I thought, well, I'm not gonna stop. Anyway, here's the menu du jour. Here's my little dim sum table. Pretty cute. But let's check out the kitchen. This thing is state of the art. This is no Brooklyn kitchen, let me tell you. Oh yeah, we got fans running, not like this kitchen here. We got an egg cooking. But hey, it's Vegetarian Wednesday. We don't need eggs today. Well, maybe we'll use one. Yeah, there's some new mini games, Calandra. I haven't seen them yet, but who knows. Anyway, I'm stoked about this. I'm gonna save it, and maybe we'll revisit this later. Oh wow, happy birthday. That's great. I wish I was still 19. You've got a whole bright world ahead of you. All right, let's save this and start cooking. Isn't that sound gratifying? Gosh darn it. Anyway, welcome back to Chef Shock. I'm very excited about tonight because we're going to make Soulritos. Today is Vegetarian Wednesday, and what that means is I'm gonna try not to use any like meat products. I'm gonna use a little cheese, a little butter, maybe some egg. But if you're not into that, just let me know, and we will talk about it. Because there's always a way around this sort of stuff. What is a Soulrito? A Soulrito is like a platter of soul food, but rolled up into a burrito for easy consumption. There's just something about it that really works. It's one of my wife's absolute favorite things. So I'm gonna be scoring a lot of points since I like had to banish her to the basement. She's fine, she's got the Netflix, everything's great. So first things first, we need to thank a couple folks. Because, man, last night was nuts. First, Twitch user DM Brandon blew us up by hosting us. That was insane. So he sent like a thousand people over here to view us cooking. So thank you, DM Brandon, you're awesome. He's like a pro Smite player, which sounds a lot more awesome than a cook, but you know, to each his own. And then we just really quickly want to thank some people who have subscribed, like TST Tookie, who subscribed overnight. A lot of numbers with the letter B in it. Goalyman13 for subscribing, Ted John, and I'll try and catch as many people as I can. But it's tough because I got burners and stuff I got to worry about. So I will do my best. Welcome Kelsey to the dance floor tonight. Kelsey is going to be monitoring the chat, letting me know whatever questions you have. And she's ultimately gonna be awesome.
Hey guys, how's it going?
Awesome, Kelsey, welcome to the party. So tonight we're gonna be making some mac and cheese to be putting inside of these Soulritos. We're also gonna be making like a veggie-fied pulled pork, which is going to be totally epic. And what else are we gonna make? Ah, quick collard greens. Now just the idea of quick collard greens, if you are a collard green person, that is like nails on the chalkboard. Collard greens are something that should be cooked very quickly, but thanks to the power of the, that should not be cooked quickly, but thanks to the power of the Dutch oven, we're gonna fire it right up. All right, so first things first, we're gonna get a pot of water going for our mac and cheese. We don't need a huge pot this time because we're only cooking about a half pound of mac and cheese. And then, yeah, we're gonna use jackfruit for this pulled pork. You wanna see it? I ordered mine straight from the Zon. It's not actually from the Amazon, but you get it. And so, yeah, we got jackfruit in cans. I think I'm gonna use like four cans today. Oh man, it's organic and young. The best, my favorite kind. I'll save these other two cans for another app. So why do I like jackfruit? Jackfruit makes a really, really good meat substitute. And the reason for that is that it has a very neutral flavor. When you get it packed in brine, which is how I have it, as opposed to a syrup, it's got a very neutral flavor. And the thing about jackfruit is that just like animal protein, it flakes. Hey, thank you for cheering. It flakes and it shreds and it mimics that texture that our canine teeth absolutely love. We still have canine teeth, and that's because deep down inside there's a critter in us that just loves pulling apart flesh. But not tonight. We'll be pulling apart the flesh of the jackfruit. It's already that time. Salt pig. We're gonna salt this water gosh darn heavily, because we like our pasta to be as salty as the sea. I'm not making my own macaroni tonight. I haven't quite found the perfect extruder. When you're making a noodle with a hole in the center, you have to extrude it, and it can get pretty wild pretty quick. Yeah. Jackfruit. What is a jackfruit? Well, it's a giant fruit. I think some people also call it breadfruit, or maybe that's like a sister thing.
Breadfruit's a little different.
They're
related, and they grow in the same parts of the world, which I believe is the Caribbean and Southeast Asia.
Oh, well, thank you for that, Kelsey. Great job. Thanks for switching to Kelsey just in time. I appreciate it. All right, so let's get this water fired up. I don't need a ton. Let's get our oven preheated, because we're going to bake this here. Macaroni and cheese. We're gonna get that heated at 350. And let's unpack some of these grockeries. Twitch did kill cable. And thank you. I'm glad you enjoy this. And thank you, Hose Beats, for cheering. I really enjoy cheers. We've got some classic elbow macaroni. Here we've got collard greens. Now, I live in a neighborhood with a lot of Caribbean influence, so these sorts of things are pretty darn common, pretty cheap. I've got about 2 pounds of collard greens. And so for the mac and cheese, I'm kind of riffing on Alton Brown's recipe, of course. That man knows mac and cheese. But for the Cook's Illustrated, one of the best recipes of all time, for the collards is from Cook's Illustrated. We got some panko breadcrumbs, Japanese breadcrumbs. They're really wild. I think in the old days, they would actually like electrocute them in order to make them the texture that they are. We've got some vegetarian stock here, veggie stock. Could I make my own? Absolutely. Is everything ruined? And feel free to say ruined all over the chat. No, nothing is ruined. I just want to show you how easy this is to like kind of pick up and play, especially with winter greens, which I think a lot of people find daunting. We've got some alliums, we got some onion, and of course we got some garlic. And then we got some other stuff floating around in the fridge. I don't really know what, but we'll get to it. Tortillas, we're gonna roll these suckers up. These are just wheat tortillas, and I double checked, these guys do not have any lard in them, which makes me just a little sad sometimes, but for tonight's application, it's gonna be great. So, let's get started. Let's make some dishes first, right? If you tuned into last night's stream, we had a couple of technical difficulties, what with the drain not holding any water, and also with the trash can not working. But the trash can works again, which really makes me happy. Well, I guess I should have unplugged my phone. Oh well. All right, that's great. So, the first thing I'm gonna do once I get that sink about half filled is work on these collard greens. Collard greens have a really tough stem in them, and that stem, it's like your least favorite part of the collard green. Gotcha. It's like the least favorite part of the collard greens. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna rib these guys, like tell them jokes and slightly make fun of them. Look at this, man. Can you believe that? That's insane. That's like, right? I feel like I'm in the Garden of Eden. That's a different show though. Man, if I was on Naked and Afraid, I tell you what, I really wanna go on that show. Does anybody else wanna go on Naked and Afraid? Not with me, but I just really feel like I've got a pretty decent survival sense, especially when it comes to eating weird stuff.
Do you have any good vegetarian substitutions for like a foie type of appetizer, like a sauteed foie?
Not a sauteed foie, but I'll tell you, in the Dirt Candy Cookbook, which was written by Amanda Cohen, and it's an incredible book. She was on Iron Chef once. Yeah, man, she crushes this like truffle mousse, and you can make it in like ice cube molds, which will give it all these like crazy distinct shapes. And it's just like, It's like one of the coolest things ever. I love that cookbook. It's written like a comic book. It's basically perfect for everybody watching. So I'm gonna line up a couple of similarly shaped leaves, maybe like three tops. I'm gonna feel where these ribs are, and then I'm just gonna kind of make like a little V cut tracing the ribs. Lemons in the chain with the V cuts. I'm gonna yank this out. Could I save this for making stock? You're absolutely right. Could I juice this and have it in a power smoothie tomorrow? You bet I could. But I'm not gonna do that tonight, simply because tomorrow I'm gonna wake up and probably have a Red Bull and start thinking about what live stuff I'm gonna cook. What's tomorrow? Tomorrow is Thrifty and Thirsty Thursday, which really makes my day. We save money on ingredients and instead make ourselves a cocktail. Definitely my kind of lifestyle. So we're ribbing these guys. And if you got any questions about collard greens or really any kind of greens, feel free to fire them at me or at Kelsey. The next cut that we're gonna do on these good guys is called a chiffonade. And chiffonade is like one of my absolute favorite things. Breakfast of champions, and it gives you wings. You're darn right. You know, my one thing about energy drinks, which, you know, dietarily, I guess some people are anti, is that I get a shot of B vitamins and then I can control them. You know, coffee in New York, it varies from shop to shop or bodega to bodega. And oftentimes it's a little unpredictable. So I don't like not having the jolt when I want it. See how easy this is? These guys are great. You know, collard greens a lot, you gotta check to see if there's dirt. They grow pretty close to the ground, but these guys are super clean and super mean. So I am, I'm pretty stoked about these. But yeah, super common in my neighborhood. We've got a lot of Caribbean influence. A lot of people moved here from the South. So yeah, we got collard greens all over the place. Missed that one. Anybody else eat collard greens? Let's see. I know, collard greens. Do you think they call them collard greens because like I'd look like, I don't know, what do you, like Elizabethan or something? Do I look like a frilly lizard? I don't know, I kinda like it. I forgot to put the pot on there, or the lid on the pot, oh well. I've got this pretty well timed out. So far, I mean, this is going off without a hitch. I can't believe like how successful last night's stream was. I'm still like reeling from it. I felt like I needed to call my mom. I actually did. She hasn't really figured out how to work Twitch yet, but maybe we'll have her call in live someday. How do you guys feel about that? Cooking with Justin's mom. It's like hanging with Mr. Cooper or something. Look, this guy is so gnarly. Could you believe that like in restaurants that don't pay attention, they would ask you to chew through this? I would like rather chew through an electrical cord that's live than chew through this. It's like, not good. Anyhow, they just get so fibrous too when they stay in like liquid for so long. So we're kind of gonna like, I guess you could say that we're gonna braise these, but I don't know, braise isn't really the right term because braise is like a very kind of low, slow, wet heat. And we're gonna start these with quick heat and then we're gonna finish them nice and low. Are you guys hearing that noise? What is that? Sounds like someone's using a drill every now and then. Oh, the fan on there? Oh, whatevs. Well, as long as it's not bothering anybody in chat, well, I ain't worried about it. Okay, so let's get these greens nice in the... Oh, I threw away the bag for the greens. I gotta get a bowl then. Oh well, I'll just use this colander for now. We're gonna end up using it for that pasta anyway. So, from here, I'm gonna show you how to chiffonade, and chiffonade just absolutely makes my day. I have a friend who used to make collard greens, my friend George, when we were in the restaurant, the most depressing thing about collard greens is like, they take up your entire workspace, and then this will like wilt down to like this much collard greens, but they're gonna be super potently flavored, which I really dig. Oh, so chiffonade. I stack these up, kind of one on top of the other, nice little congruency there. And then I'm gonna roll it up just like a cigar. And then we're gonna, which makes nice little ribbons. Anybody at home cooking along with me? Last night, somebody on my Twitter, actually, heck, I got my phone here. Let's just pull it out and check it out. Somebody on my Twitter went ahead and made fresh pasta, which really like, I mean, that's like the most flattering thing that anyone could do is say like, thank you for leading me to my fresh pasta destiny. Check it out, Jacket Thief on Twitter. Doesn't that look delicious? Can you switch cams there? Beautiful. Oh my goodness, way to go, Jacket Thief, you nailed it. I totally favorited that. I even RT'd it, amazing. All right, so chiffonade. You know, these don't have to be like razor thin. This is not basil. I want these to maintain some texture. So I don't know, maybe like half inch, quarter inch, something like that. I like them when they get really long so that when you pull them, they go all over the map. It's the best. And isn't that easy? See how we're just like mowing through this and giving them all like a nice uniform shape? Beautiful. Congratulations, everybody. You just shipping nada da 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 da. Twitch staff. We got any questions? Oh boy, the oven just preheated. My favorite sound of all. Let's me know. Hey, that oven showed up ready to work.
Yeah, actually, Justin, Magic Batman's asking, what was the show that you were on when you had the jelly restaurant concept?
Oh,
I remember
God.
That. That's
what was the show that I was on when I was on the jelly restaurant concept? So the first show I was on was called 24-Hour Restaurant Battle, and I had no idea how to cook. I, like, made a couple sandwiches, like, in the bagel shop or something growing up. And so I applied for this kind of on a whim. I might have been, like, still in the intoxicated stages of hungover when I did this. I don't know. But the gal I was with at the time, we'd talked about like a really fun brunch concept would be to make like pancakes, waffles, and French toast, and everything came with like a cool butter and a cool jelly. So when I was on this show, they call it 24-Hour Restaurant Battle, but like I only had like less than half a day to cook because I also had to design the restaurant and yada yada, and it was just me. So instead of like taking the time to make like pectin-based jellies, I made all these crazy gels with agar agar. And people lost it. It was so good. Yeah, so that was that. It was called 24-Hour Restaurant Battle. It was hosted by my dude, Scott Conant. Scott Conant is on Chopped currently. And the other day, I was at this party with Guy Fieri. I don't know if you guys know him. If you do know him, you're probably the people that are calling him Daddy all over his Instagram. But yeah, Scott like stops this whole thing, and he's like, hey, I was on this show with this guy, 24-Hour Restaurant Battle. I'm like, dude. I might be kind of trying to forget that, but that's all right. I at least I made an impression. Oh yeah, Jeffrey Zakarian was also a judge on that show. Now he's on Cooks versus Cons, but anyway. Man, there's a lot of racket going on. A lot of people subscribing, huh? Hot diggity. Oh, Bernicus, thank you. You've paid attention. Unplug the microwave now so that it doesn't make the noise later. Thank you for that. You're hired, I tell you what. Do I need the microwave? No, I don't need the microwave. So we've made really short work of these collard greens. A little bit of rib in there. Get it out. You can kind of see already, even just like when you break them down like this, they start getting really small and compact. And then they're gonna cook down into almost nothing. There's my little scraper over here. Great, so we got these guys. Now we're gonna do some more knife work. We're gonna take care of our alliums. That's our onion and our garlic. I'm gonna get a couple little landing strips for them. See here, bang, bang. Hot diggity. How else we doing? Let's see, did I even do anything with my day today? I don't know. Should we go over how to cut the onion again? I feel like we should. So we're gonna take the top off first. And I'm sorry if you've been tuned in and you know how to cut an onion. So it's a lot of people, man, it can get dangerous, it can get weird. And I just think that we could all use a little refresher every now and then. So I cut the top off. I'm gonna leave the root part, this little part down here, intact. And then I'm gonna cut it in half yet again, just like so. And that makes it pretty easy. Watch it jinx me. That makes it really easy to peel off this external skin. Thank you for saying this stream is quite professional compared to the other streams. That's dope.
And Syphus is asking, do you use separate cutting boards for meat, veggies, and fish?
In general, it's good practice to use separate cutting boards for meat, veggie, and fish. But as you can see here, I try and group all of my veg and get it where it needs to be. They call this mise en place in like French kitchens. It means literally like having one stuff together. So I try and do all of my veg work first, then attack meats. Flip the board or get a separate cutting board altogether. All in all though, I don't know. I don't know. Cross-contamination for me, it's a real thing. I'm just like on autopilot for it. I've worked in a restaurant. Once you've been like surveyed by the New York City Health Department, like things like cross contamination, it's like always on your mind. So I guess I don't even think about that. It's just always, like even in a fridge, a lot of people store their meat on top, but your meat on top, it can leak onto every other thing in your fridge. So for me, meat's always on the bottom. If I even have meat in the fridge, it's like I'll move the produce from one drawer to the other, or I'll make sure it's in like a container like this where it's not gonna leak. Store-bought containers are forever leaking. All right, so now we're gonna cut this onion and we're gonna start this way. I like to get my knife right in that angle right there, and then we'll make the first cut parallel to the board, and we're not gonna go all the way through. That root then keeps this intact. You can see it's already getting really excited about getting cut. You bet it. So we'll do one more. I don't even know that I'm gonna use all two onions. I'm just like not feeling it today. Maybe, we'll see. We'll see how it goes.
Andromeda 5 or Andromeda V, you can tell me which one that is asking, if you're a strong taster, what's a good way to cut the bitterness of greens without losing too much flavor? I say nutmeg generally.
Yeah, nutmeg's a good call. You know, I think when you're cooking greens, a lot of people don't even think to like, they'll add garlic, plenty of garlic, but they don't think to add onion. And onion, once you cook it, is a natural sweetening agent. I think there are a lot of ways that you can go. I also think a natural foil to bitter greens is fat. I have in my book, which we'll talk about later. Oh yeah, it's getting hot in here. In my book, I have this theory that it's like if you work with bitter things, say coffee, you need to add some cream and you need to add some sugar. So by adding fat and by adding sweetness, you're muting the less desirable qualities of bitterness. I definitely enjoy some bitterness, and I think in a dish like this, it definitely serves its place. The collard greens are actually going to be the most refreshing part of this entire thing. Kind of a somewhat heavy barbecue flavor, a lot of smoke going on, and then we'll also have the richness of the mac and cheese. So the only real palate cleanser in this dish is going to be the bitterness of the greens. So I've sliced each onion that way, and now we're going to do the what I call the vertical cuts, up and down, up and down. You guys see nice and close there? Oh man, look at this. And it's like really okay if some of these fall apart, especially for tonight's application. We're not really like that picky about the greens. Greens are like the kind of thing that I think the more finesse you put into them and the more refined you try and make them, the more you're doing them a disservice. I feel like greens just in general are like, they're like the last things that you eat of the season. You store them for a long time. They're just like a, kind of like a, I don't know, to me they're like a grandma food, you know? And I don't think grandma would like, maybe your grandma would, but I don't know, my imaginary grandma would not take the intense amount of time to make sure her onions are perfectly diced. But whatever. So now we're gonna cut this way, which is across all of the other cuts that we've done. And look at that, we have perfectly square little onion bits. If someone could design an onion that didn't fan out, I would love that, but that's never gonna happen. Something tells me that they would have done that already. All right. So now that we know how to cut an onion, I'm gonna start speeding it up and mow through this here. Any Animal Crossing players out there? I was so excited. I mean, like that game is what, like 4 years old now, and they just released this update today. That's just like incredible. Such fan service. I'm really excited to have a use for all of my Animal Crossing amiibo, which you can see down here. My wife, that actually Animal Crossing was like the game that I got my wife sold on. It was dope. Oh, and yeah, and I started, actually, Chrissy Teigen, we were talking about her yesterday. I did a show with her once, and I like made friends with her via Twitter, being her like guidance counselor going through Animal Crossing. It was so wild. But like, she had never played the game before, and I was trying to explain to her that what the point is, you know, like there's a point. Not really, I guess it's just to get rich and pay off your house and get more stuff, right? All right, so we got onions done. I think this is actually gonna be enough for tonight's application. I got two just in case, but I don't know. I feel like we're gonna be all right. If I need to double back and make more onion, then you know what? We certainly can. All right, we got our onion taken care of. I'm gonna check on our water, see how it's doing. Something tells me it's at a boil. How you doing? Woo! It's like Ric Flair boil. Woo! Let's see, garlic. I think we need like maybe 4 things of garlic tonight? I don't know. What do you think? Let's check the run of show and see what I told myself when I was dreaming this up. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, let's use like, Let's use three garlics. How about that? Three cloves of garlic. What are people saying over here in the chats? You think this is just like real life? Amazing. That's the goal. You know, when we started building the idea for this, I said, I think the most revolutionary thing to do would be to cook. Go figure. And thank you for cheering for that. That's amazing. I should, you know, you're right. I should be cooking turnips since today is like an Animal Crossing day. You're totally right. Shucks, man. What a missed opportunity. Joan the boar is just like sighing and harumphing. Everything's ruined because I should have made the turnips. All right. So I'm just crushing this garlic and then I'm going to give it a little mince. If you've ever watched anyone cook, generally they start by crushing their garlic. I hate garlic presses. I think my mentor, Mr. Brown over there, would sigh at seeing a garlic press. I think garlic press is kind of a unitasker, but I don't know, if you have one, like if you don't like going to the effort, then go by all means, use your garlic press. You know, I used to have to take my garlic out to be pressed. You know, like my linens, you know, my suits.
Got it, yeah.
All right, moving on. Moving on, gosh. It's like an old joke. Anyway, back when like garlic presses were like du jour. This isn't especially fatty clove, so I'm gonna slide in here. You know what, this knife is bugging me. I've used it too much in the past couple days, so I'm gonna true it up just a little bit. Say hi to Max Rebo over here. Max Rebo, a Star Wars character. He's like one of my all-time favorite sci-fi characters because he's a glutton. All he does is he works for food at Jabba's palace. And you know what's really funny? His species is called Ortolan or Ortolan, which is this like crazy bird. Are you familiar with Ortolan?
I should be. I'm getting the Star Wars education.
Okay. Well, so Ortolan is like actually a real thing that you can eat in real life. And I think it's now illegal to eat it in I want to say Italy is where it's most popular. But due to the method of consumption, which we probably shouldn't even be talking about on Vegetarian Wednesday, but due to the method of consumption, you put a shroud over your head to shield yourself from like the, I don't know, the things that would judge you for consuming such an innocent creature. But yeah, it's cool that whoever invented that character over at Lucasfilm was like, yeah, let's name it after this bird that is really only for gluttons. I think they drowned the bird in cognac first, or brandy, or something like that. Isn't that freaky? All right. You know, some people, everybody asks me, you want to get in close on that? Some people ask me about this little green bit in the middle of the garlic, and guess what? Justin Warner doesn't care. I don't know. If that scares you or if it offends you, we should probably move on. I eat garlic scapes. Do you eat garlic scapes,
Kelsey? Garlic scapes are delicious.
Garlic scapes are basically this green thing, but
given more time, more green thing.
Yeah, given more time, right. Yeah, this is almost like a delicacy. This is like a fetal garlic scape. Anyway, I don't know why they're called scapes though. They're not like trying to escape or anything. They're normal. Now, I'll tell you what, just chewing that knife up, it's just mowing through this. The dogs are hungry, you know? This knife just wants to cut. Whenever I'm on competitive shows, man, the knives are always so sharp. Even by like a compared to a restaurant's quality knife, and they get so sharp they actually scare me. So I always remind them that I remind myself by saying the dogs are hungry.
They just want to cut.
Thank you for following. I love seeing Nom, especially in like all of my favorite colors, just randomly appear. You're right, Justin Warner don't care. Maybe we should put my head on a honey badger, because I feel like a lot of cooking, I don't really care that much. Uh-oh. Does that sound like flippant or nonchalant? I do care, but I think so many people are so worried about cooking all the time, and I don't know. Could you imagine if that very famous cookbook was called The Anxiety of Cooking instead of The Joy of Cooking? Something tells me it wouldn't be leaping off the shelves. Oh, wow. All right, so we got some garlic here. Let's see what's next. I think we're gonna grate some cheese. How's that sound? Right, cheese? I think the appropriate answer is great. All right, so we're gonna use some cheddar cheese. Wait, where did the sheath for this thing go? Great job. Look at that, fell right off. Oh well. All right, so let's get some cheese out of here.
Where is this cheese? Oh, over here.
Beautiful, look at this. The Farmhouse Reserve. Premium aged cheddar cheese. Oh look, we have two. We have Alpine style, and we have Farmhouse Reserve. Look at that, a two cheese blend. I have a friend that he likes to indulge sometimes in some of the pleasures of the earth, and anytime he mixes, like, say, two strains of cheese, he calls it a two cheese blend. So that always makes me chuckle. Shout out to Samir. That's his name. I don't know if Samir's watching. He probably should. Oh well. So cheddar, man, is such a rich cheese that I like to keep it really refrigerated, and because it starts to sweat, and when it sweats, it doesn't grate very well. It starts to crumble, and crumbles don't melt as easily as shreds. They're not nearly as great. So I'm gonna grate this big pile of cheese. And in the interim, if you got any questions, comments, or concerns, please fire it at me. Oh wow, Vermont. Yeah, Vermont's a great state, man. I think they're one of the most gourmet of all states, what with cheese, what with maple syrup. Vermont's
absolutely
great.
I mean, dairy is life. That would be my problem with the veganism, so I'm all about milk and cream, and Vermont makes some of the best.
Yeah, right?
Daddy Goldblum's asking, what's the difference between panko and regular breadcrumbs, since those will be coming up?
Oh, yeah. It's really, honestly, it's about surface area and how they are produced. Thank you, Daddy Goldblum, and also thank you for making that cool cartoon of me and my dog. That was really sweet. Shout out to you. So panko breadcrumbs, one, are Japanese style. And like I said earlier, and feel free to call me out if I'm making this up, but I think in the old days, they would actually kind of like electrocute bread dough. And that would like shoot this, like, not bread dough, but like a bready type liquid. And that would cause this like unique texture. And so panko breadcrumbs are less dense. They're more airy. They're bigger. But in general, I would say compared to your average breadcrumb, there is less bread in a panko breadcrumb than there is in a normal breadcrumb because it's like exploded. I'd love for somebody to get out a microscope, you know, and show me the difference. Is that a thing? You producer types, why don't you check it out on Google and see if you can show me the, like, zoomed in on one, like, panko breadcrumb and one normal breadcrumb. I'm sure you can do that. Right? Since all we're doing is grating cheese here.
And also, Taurus4 asks, what are your tips for improving knife skills, just in general?
Oh my goodness. Tips for improving knife skills, man. I wish I could say anything other than sharp knives and practice, because even I, like, by comparison to almost anybody who does this kind of thing, I have terrible, terrible knife skills. I just, like, I've got bad handwriting, you know, and I feel like it's just kind of like an extension of that, and I'm just really bad at it. It's just never been my thing, like, tourneying potatoes. If you really want to get good at knife work, look up tourney and potato, and you'll like very quickly either fall into one of two camps, which is knife skills are worth it, or forget this, I'm never going to tourney another potato in my life. So basically, you turn a potato into a very tiny football shape, and I don't know, it's kind of pointless, other than for presentation's sake. It's like great if you have like a prison, you know, and you want people to toil all day. But yeah, for me, I'm never gonna do that. Yes, I am from New York, and I'm glad you like this this shirt. We're cooking out of my very own Brooklyn kitchen right now. And this shirt was given to me by this dude, Biggie, not the Biggie from New York, but this dude, Biggie, who runs a thing called DeliFreshThreads.com. And he doesn't pay me to say that, but I don't know. I was feeling these orange pants today. Yeah? Yeah! I was feeling these orange pants and I wanted something that would go with it. And, you know.
Deli Fresh Threads is actually in the chat tonight.
Deli Fresh?
Yep, asking if there will be a sandwich tomorrow for National Sandwich Day.
You know, that's something I didn't even think about. I tell you what, tomorrow's recipe is, if I'm not mistaken, it's pork chops, right?
Yes.
Yeah, and so for tomorrow's recipe, we could be like G.I. Joe's and immediately make that into a pork chop sandwich.
I think that sounds fantastic.
Right? A Vietnamese pork chop sandwich? Does that even exist? Yeah. And if not, why doesn't it?
Yeah, why not? Why can't it exist?
Terrifying, huh? Oh, thank you. Yeah, it is kind of red-orange. Nice, Taurus4. Maybe we'll see each other on the subway sometime. Right? Oh, thank you for Secret 911 for hosting us. That's amazing. I really appreciate that. Yeah, you guys remember, am I dating myself? That's like a very early internet funny thing, was the G.I. Joes that say pork chop sandwiches. No? No? Ben's back there, 25 years old, doesn't know. Oh, you're 24. So sorry.
Makes a big difference.
Right? I'm just jealous of your facial hair, man.
And Conthus actually came up and said, panko is made from bread baked by electrical current, which yields a bread without a crust, and then grinding said bread to create fine slivers of crumb. It has a crispier, airier texture than most types of breading found in Western cuisine and resists absorbing oil or grease when fried, resulting in a lighter coating.
Boom, and there you have it. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, I said they electrocute it. So yeah, I was right about that, hot diggity. You know, I don't know, I feel like we need to have some, not that I'm selling out, but I feel like we should have some co-branding, like panko, the official breadcrumb of ChefShock, the shockingly real cooking, shocking breadcrumbs. Yeah. All right. So now we got the cheese grated. That's pretty exciting. Now, and man, this is where it's gonna get really, really heady. We're gonna make a roux. And so I'm gonna measure out all this stuff to make a roux. Let me corral this cheese, man. A roux, if you're not familiar, is like the very classic way to make a cheese sauce, also called a mornay. But I hate saying mornay because it sounds like it's a lot more fancy than what it actually is. Mornay is just very chill cheese sauce. Mornay sounds like you could charge $15 for it, right? So the general rule of thumb when you're making a roux is equal parts of fat and flour. You don't have to really like hold hard and true to that, but I'm gonna do about 3 tablespoons of flour and 3 tablespoons of butter. There we have it. In terms of vegan things, by all means use your vegan cheese. While it does make me a little nervous, I really think it would work well, if not better, in a roux-based sauce due to the stabilizers that are in it that create that sort of cheesy type consistency. And then also, if you're not into butter, just use like the vegan butter stuff. That stuff is dope. Or you could use any other. I mean, in my opinion, don't you think you could use any other really like shelf firm fat? You could use Crisco if you wanted to, right? Or
Absolutely.
Any other brand of vegetarian shortening.
I've tried to do weird roux kind of made with Asian flavors with coconut oil and coconut milk, and that comes out pretty interesting.
Huh, interesting like good or interesting,
interesting
like...
good depending on what you're gonna use it in. I wouldn't put it in mac and cheese, you know, but it's great for a curry.
Right. All right, so we're gonna measure out 1 tablespoon of mustard powder here. Mustard powder is like vital in mac and cheese. It gives it color, it gives it a lot of good flavor. Cheese is sulfury, and it loves mustard. Cheese loves mustard. In general, you should not ever measure over whatever you're doing, but I kind of like doing it just to bend the rules because somewhere a home ec teacher is just like shrieking, you know? I don't know. I was the only dude in my school to get the home ec award, which means that you crushed it in both cooking and sewing. Deal with that. That was really fun. People made a lot of fun of me for that. Is Bobby Flay on Twitch? Something tells me nah. I don't know. Maybe it's a generational thing. I wouldn't put it past him though. Cause I don't know, Bobby Flay, he's very hip, man. His restaurant, honest to God, is one of the best restaurants I've been to in New York in a long time. This is the sign of somebody who left the butter out from last night's stream, grabbed it after too many Sambucas and threw it into the fridge, but I'm just gonna guesstimate at what 2 tablespoons of butter is. What do you say? You think we should make this in our cast iron pan? Right?
I say yeah, absolutely.
All right, so.
The stove to the oven.
Now that this is definitely at a boil, I'm gonna transfer this pot of water back here onto the simmer station. Cool. I'm gonna turn this heat off.
Now, Andromeda 5 is asking, when you're doing a vegetarian dish, do you pay attention to what enzymes or rennet is used in the cheese? Like, how strict are you with that?
You know, that's a great question. I could probably, if I was going vegan, I could probably pay more attention and use like a thistle-based rennet. If you guys aren't familiar with rennet is kind of like the stuff that turns cheese from milk into a separatable curd. So you got curd and you got whey. See whey, if it's Mexican cheese. Anyway, you can get rennets from multiple places. You can get rennets from the guts of animals, and you can get rennets from thistles. I think you can even get rennet from like fig branches or something like that. But yeah, for tonight, I'm not too crazy about it. If you are, by all means, go on ahead and figure it out. How about that? Does that answer the question? All right, great. All right, so now I got my my butter here. So we're good there. I'm gonna add a little paprika to this. You know what? Just because I got it, I know I got it somewhere. Where do I got it? Let's use some fancy smoked paprika. How does that sound? And then that'll echo the smoke that we're gonna have in the barbecue. That's gonna be dope. There we go, look at that. I'm just gonna add like a touch of this, a whisper. Oh, that smell, man, I wish you could smell it. It just smells like so, like, smells like a red pepper came home from a campfire, right? Veggie rennet is cheaper. Thank you, Ender. What am I cooking? Yeah, if you're just tuning in, we're making what I call Soulritos. It's Vegetarian Wednesday, so we're gonna make a vegetarian soul food plate, and then we're gonna roll it all up in a burrito, and it's gonna be absolutely delish. If you like what you're seeing, by all means, go on ahead and subscribe. If you're on Twitch Prime, and if you've got a free sub coming to you, I know where we could catch that. That'd be right over here. All right, so we've got almost everything completely mised out. We're ready to go on with our roux. We could put the pasta in, but it's really quick cooking. We're gonna use half of this box. It says it's ready in 8 minutes, so we'll chill on that. Why don't we get these greens going in the Dutch oven? Yeah, buddy. I'm really bummed that I wasted my Dutch oven joke last night. That was way too early in the game. I should have held on to that. Oh well. All right, so I got this on like, I don't know, medium-high-ish heat. I'm gonna add some veg oil. Got just a little bit over here. I don't know, 2 tablespoons, 1 tablespoon. It's, by the end of the dish, it's not really gonna matter at all. You're not gonna notice any like really oily consistency. Maybe don't put a half gallon in, how about that? So we'll see. Stream dying for anyone else? I sure hope not. That would be a bummer. All right, so we're gonna let that heat up. We're gonna add our onion first. See why I like doing this? Because we can set all of this up in order. We can add our onion first. We're gonna add half of that. We can add our garlic. We can add some red pepper flakes. And then we can add our greens. I'm gonna let that oil heat up. And then I'm gonna focus on getting this pan ready to make our roux. And you guessed it, we're gonna do some like simultaneous cooking. Watch out, guys. It could be weird. I'm gonna use 2 implements to manipulate these. This is one of my most favorite things of all time. This is called a sauce whisk. You see, it's like a whisk that got compressed. I love these guys. Sauce whisk is great for when you're cooking in a shallow pan like this, but you still wanna break up, say, flour globules. All right, so we got that. This is going. I'm doing about medium-high heat on this guy. We're gonna add the butter, see what it does. It's gonna melt. So let's get our onions going in here, about half, because we're gonna use the other half in the mac and cheese. Call me crazy, onions in the mac and cheese. I've got this guy on standby here. Once that butter is good and melted, what we're gonna do is add those dry ingredients, and we're gonna smear it around until it becomes dry and a little toasty. We'll be making a blonde roux, which has a lot of thickening power. And then we're gonna add some milk. Oh boy.
Larm2 asks, Dutch ovens are expensive. If you were gonna buy one size, what would you get?
The biggest Dutch oven is the size that I would get. Because you can always fit something small into a big Dutch oven. I know that Dutch ovens are expensive, but I mean, to me, they're like one of the priceless things that I have. I feel like I would take one Dutch oven and one cast iron skillet almost anything. Great thing about a Dutch oven too, you know, you could put this in a fireplace and cook with it. You could take it camping with you. It's a little heavy, but they're just great, man. I love them. The way that they hold and retain heat, you can turn your oven into like a, basically like a slow cooker. Just put your oven at 225, put almost any tough cut of meat in here with liquid, and it's bombshell. So good. Okay, so I'm staging my milk over here, because I'm gonna add the milk to the roux next. See how I'm working from all sides here? I'm gonna manipulate these good guys over here with these rubber-tipped, what do you call these things? Tongs. I almost said pinchers. So these rubber-tipped tongs so that I don't scrape up the cast enamel of the Dutchie. After we add the milk over here, we're gonna add the rest of the onions. See how I'm working? And you know what? Maybe because I'm crazy, I think we can drop the pasta as well. It's like a DJ, man. It's like the Ed Sullivan show over here. You know that guy who spins all the plates, you know, Ed Sullivan? That's good. We'll get that ready to go over here. Onions are getting a little translucent. Not perfect yet, but we'll add that garlic. Red pepper flakes on standby. We can retire this oil because I need it no longer.
Now, I know it's the Vegetarian Wednesday, but Renee G.T. Smith saying, have you ever dry aged or wet aged meat? And is that something that you like to do? Do you prefer it?
That's a great question. I do love dry aging meat. I've never had wet aged meat. That sounds scary and interesting, which means that I'm down. You know, due to spatial constraints here in New York, and also due to the fact that my wife is very much largely a vegetarian, having hunks of meat in front of a fan as they kind of slowly degrade is not optimal for my house. But I do have a really great butcher here in Brooklyn, Paisanos, and Paisanos has all that dry aging stuff right there. And so the cool thing is I can just go down there and I can get whatever I want, which really makes my day. The next thing that we're gonna need in this operation, oh, and tune in next Meaty Monday. I believe next Meaty Monday, we're gonna be doing a dry-aged ribeye au poivre. I know it sounds fancy, huh? Where'd I put that veggie stock? Oh, there it is. All right, veggie stock's the next thing that's gonna go in. Actually, it's gonna go in right here. And we're gonna use that to kind of deglaze. If you wanna come in real tight right there, can you see it? Let's turn on the light for you, huh?
Is that light on?
Oh, well. Yeah, see those little brown bits? That's the good stuff. All right, let's back it up. Now over here to our butter, we're gonna add our flour and our spices, and you can see that that's starting to sizz. Oh yeah. And so this paste that we're making here is called a roux. And so I'm gonna cook this until it starts to smell just a little nutty. You can go longer and lower and slower with it, but the thickening power will be less. When people make gumbo, they like a really dark roux because it adds this really interesting kind of nutty, I sat on the stove for an entire day sort of flavor to your gumbo. Actually, I had to judge a show the other day where they made gumbo. So right now, I'm not kidding you, this smells... It smells like dough, like the pasta dough we made last night, and that's not where I want it. So I'm gonna let this cook for just a little bit longer. I'm gonna keep whisking it until that kind of like raw flour smell gets cooked out, because that's kind of a bummer of a flavor. All right, let's drop our pasta over here. I'm not gonna set a timer, because I like to live dangerously. And let's be honest, we're making mac and cheese, so this is gonna get covered in cheese sauce and baked. And once you're doing that, people, like, the last thing that they ask about mac and cheese is like, oh, these noodles, they're not perfectly al dente. They're like, just give me the cheese, bro. We got a lot of racket going over there. People are liking us and watching us and subscribing and stuff. Thank you so much for that, everybody. I'm sorry I am dealing with flames and whatnot. Next Meaty Monday, man, when we make the steak au poivre, we're actually gonna flambé. And I'm not kidding you, I'm gonna have to take these graphics off of them. You know, because our budget was so good for these graphics. I'm gonna make flames that I'm not kidding you go up to here. I'll have to clear the area of all plushies. That's actually very dangerous. You shouldn't do that, but luckily, I'm a professional. Now we're gonna add a pinch of red pepper flakes to these good guys over here. They're gonna kind of work to just add a little heat to the end product. I feel that greens can often be very, very boring, and that's not gonna be the case with ours. This is looking great over here. So now I'm gonna add about 3 cups of milk.
Bananas2 is asking, what is your guilty pleasure and why is it tacos?
It's taquitos. If you tuned into the stream yesterday, it's taquitos. For me, it's food that rolls. How do I know that's 3 cups? Because this is a quart, and so I left a quarter of it in there. Great question, thanks for asking. So now we're gonna whisk this up together. And we're gonna add our onions. Why didn't I add the onions first? Because I don't need any brownness on these onions. I don't think people need to find crispy onion bits in their mac and cheese. So I'm basically boiling these onions in milk and a roux. And you're gonna see that this is gonna get nice and thick. It's gonna get like a nappe consistency, which I don't think we've talked about yet. But you can remember nappe consistency, like the nappe roots. I think that would be an incredible like culinary hip hop group, the nappe roots. Anyone? Y'all gone up and done it? Yeah, anytime a sauce comes to nappe consistency, I say y'all gone up and done it. If you read my book, you'd see it in there. All right, so check it. Here's where we're at here. These got a lot of color on them. I'm starting to get the sniffles from the chili flake. The onions, the garlic is turning a little brown. That's good. It's not totally cooked. It's not ruined. So I'm gonna add half these greens.
Sky High's asking, isn't it bad to mix stuff with iron metal on the metal pan? You're stirring in your cast iron.
What do you mean? Oh, this is not metal. This is actually, it's covered with silicone, which is why I love it. So yeah, you've got a really good eye, but you gotta get up earlier if you're gonna get ahead of this guy. You know what I'm saying?
But couldn't you also use a metal utensil on cast iron if it's been properly seasoned?
I don't know about that, and I'm not gonna recommend that because I feel like there might be a chance for property destruction there. And unfortunately, this show does not yet have insurance. Bummer. So basically what I'm doing here is I'm stir frying these greens. No, you don't need a wok to stir fry. You absolutely do not have to have that. And what this does is it makes room in this very small pot. So I don't have to use my like gigantic steamer pot to make these. You see how when I put them in, they were up here. Now already just after a couple minutes, they're way down low. See all those brown bits? Now if you watch things and if you like to cook, you're gonna say, Justin, what about those brown bits? You need them. Are you gonna deglaze the pan? Well, you're darn tootin' I'm gonna deglaze the pan, and we're gonna use vegetarian stock.
Now that cat, your Dutch oven there, it holds a lot of heat, but Claim Jumper wants to know, have you ever cooked with copper or silver pans or any other metal with really high heat conductivity, and why do you prefer this over that?
Well, if you want to see me cook with copper or silver or something like that, you better be subscribed, and you might want to consider hitting that donate button, because it's not going to happen in the Warner household, at least not yet. And no, I've never used it. I'd love to, but I don't think that that's like the everyman's pot or every woman's pot or the everyone's pot. These things I always try and keep it cheap, keep it simple, find like the law of diminishing returns before it becomes ineffective or scary. Let me see here, I'm gonna rinse this good guy out. Cause over here, once this cooks up just a little bit more and gets to nappe consistency, I'm going to, I'm deglazing right now, I should have warned you. I'm gonna add a cup, something like that. And then I'm gonna use my my silicone here to scrape up all those little brown bits on there.
Unpaid Sater's wondering, are you going to be discussing proper care for cast iron in any future shows?
Yeah, maybe I'll talk about that. You know, I think really it would be fun once we get this whole project like off the ground and not in its like baby stage. I think that like it would be so cool to talk about, I don't know, just like gear and tips and maybe just have like a little fireside chat with your boy Jay Money, as opposed to having to do all this like crazy multitasking with like a run of show and stuff like that. Maybe we could just hang out, you know, and talk about maintaining our cast iron. We'll see. Now that we have room, the rest of the greens are going to go in and we're done there. I'm going to make sure every little bit of green is out because that pasta is just about to approach its final destination. For all you Smash Brothers players, or for people that like that really ridiculous movie. I've never seen it, but I heard it was ridiculous. Maybe I shouldn't be so quick to judge. Look, you can see this is starting to get a little foamy. And I feel like we need to break out the VIP tasting spoon to really articulate the concept of nappe, which we are approaching.
Lark is asking, any tips for maintaining a Dutch oven and getting stains off the enamel?
Oh man, dude, that's the most depressing thing. I would contact your manufacturer. I don't have any information on that currently, but stains bum me out, man, especially when you're working in like television and whatnot. Man, the execs, man, they really get on you if you got a dirty looking cast iron or whatever, a dirty looking Dutch oven. They really don't like it. All right, so just for the sake of space and relations, I'm gonna let this go for a long time. I'm literally gonna put it on the back burner. It's not just a fun metaphor for ignoring stuff. Look at that. Let's get out of the VIP spoon. Is it in here? Oh man.
You know, as far as the enamel goes, I've personally found that Easy Off, that really intense oven cleaner.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Easy Off is dope.
Really well.
Right? All right, we're gonna come over here and we're gonna drain our pasta using two towels. I got two towels. Some people might say you should turn the burner off first, but like I said, I like to live dangerously. Boom. Are we done with this pot? I don't know. We'll investigate. Oh man, look at these elbows.
Vale of Lore is saying, do you judge your wife's food when she cooks for you?
Do I judge my wife's food? No, and that's because I want to live a nice long life. And I like it when people cook for me, you know? My wife's not trying to win $10,000, you know, to give to her favorite charity or whatever when she's cooking for me. Most of the time, she's just being like chill and sweet and cool and lovely. All right, so let's talk about nappe. You can see that this good guy is really starting to bubble up. That's good. I'm really excited about this. So here's my dark colored spoon. And do you see the way that that's sticking there? Normal milk does not do that. When you can write your name or like a cool initial, like that, J Money, well, it's kind of a money. Oh man, it tastes good too. You know that you're at nappe consistency. How exciting is that? So, now what we're gonna do is a pretty complex process called tempering an egg. Right behind you, pal, don't move. Tempering an egg is kind of scary. You gotta use this technique when you're making gray ice creams. We got dabs? Oh my God. John Limitless, thank you for keeping the lights on. Look at our dabs. If you've never seen the dabs before on this program, dabs are a fish that I had one time in San Diego. And, oh man, Pixel Raider. Who knows? Yeah, anyway, when you keep the lights on, I put up the dabs, and that's a really great fish. Actually, if you've played Animal Crossing, you may have caught a dab before. So, egg is gonna go in here. Into a little thingy on the side. And so this egg is hovering at about, I don't know, 40 degrees from the frigeroo. And this over here, this sauce is hovering at about 200. And so the idea here is, unless I want like egg drop soup in my mac and cheese, which I definitely do not, I need to add a little bit of this at a time in order to just kind of warm up the egg yolk. They call it tempering. I'm bringing the egg to temperature. First, I need to give it a quick beat down. People are like, why are you adding egg to this? Well, egg is gonna add some body. It's gonna keep things really stuck together, better than cheese will, because we've got the white in here, which is protein as opposed to fat, which is the cheese. And also because Alton Brown told me to do it, and then I started thinking about it, and I was like, yeah, dude, you're totally right. We're kind of like making like a carbonara mac and cheese. Sounds delicious, right? All right. He's got a sick recipe for breakfast carbonara in his new book. Oh my God, it makes my day. All right, so here we go. I'm adding just a little bit of this at the time. And so there we go. I'm gonna swirl it around.
Z-Lost Gaming says that your dab game has really improved since the start.
What do you mean my dab game?
Your dab.
Oh, my dab game?
Yeah.
Thank you so much. Well, I was kind of taken by surprise on all the original dabs. Like, I didn't think anyone would care or like us. So I was always taken by surprise. So I'm just adding a little bit more at a time in here and swirling it around. And right now I can tell you that this egg, you can see that it is not cooked. It is not egg yolk, or egg drop soup rather. And it's at like 60 plus degrees. Add just a little more. And a little more. Once you really get at it, you can add a ton at a time. And once we've added like about that much, we can add the whole thing. Goodbye, goodbye. We're done with all this. Now comes the fun part. Oh yeah, roll that beautiful cheese footage. I stole that from the baked beans guy. Who cares?
Jewish Kwanzaa asks, do you think as a chef that you have to like all foods, or do you or other chefs know that you have foods that you just can't eat because of personal preference and taste?
That's a great question, and nobody asked me that question, so thank you, Jewish Kwanzaa, for eating that. Making that question. Here's the idea. Oh my God, look, this is like real cheese sauce, guys. Look at it. It's just coming together so nice. That's like beyond my wildest Alfredo-y dreams. Holy goodness. Much cheddar. Super thick. This is like game over mac and cheese. Oh,
and
man.
Cooter Brown added, Coca-Cola cleans enamel great.
Oh, cool. So thank you for that tip, everybody. If you want to listen to him, and if it for some reason it were to not work, you can definitely sue him and not me or her. Back to this, are there things that I don't like to eat, shouldn't eat? I notoriously do not have dislikes. Notoriously. Name anything, put it in the comments, I'll answer. Do I like it 9 times out of 10, 99 times out of 100? I will like it. But I think that when, as a chef, no, I don't have to, you don't have to like everything. That's perfectly fine. Oh, in case you couldn't tell, the pasta is going into the cheese, right? Maybe I could have used a little bit more pasta, but that's only gonna expand and get more waterlogged and whatnot. Who cares? Does anyone really care that maybe there's more cheese sauce than there is pasta? Didn't think so. All right, but when you're judging food and like when you're on these shows and you're like trying to make a difference in somebody's life or whatever, I think that you absolutely have a responsibility to separate your personal feelings from this because, you know, like you can't knock, if you don't like dandelion greens, don't knock me for it, you know what I mean? Like that's actually your problem, not mine, you know, as a cook. So yeah, that's where I'm at. It's time to use the panko. We're gonna make a little crumb top. Do I got any free pans? I got free pans. I'm just gonna use this old pasta pot. I don't care. Do you? I wiped it out. Everything should be good. Let's get just a little more butter.
We actually have a few people asking, have you tried and do you like durian?
Yes, I love durian. As a matter of fact, if I'm not mistaken, let me make sure the heat's down or actually.
Milk candies in there?
Off here. I think I have durian readily available. Oh man, it's up here in my international drawer.
I like that your international drawer is a shelf.
Yeah, it's my international drawer. Look, you think I'm crazy? Like, that's crickets. Cricket powder. That's international if there ever was one.
Are you gonna be cooking with crickets at any time?
Nah, that was a different show. Anyway, I got freeze-dried durian, but it's way in the back, so just relax. If you haven't tried durian or you wanna start trying durian, freeze-dried is definitely the way to do it. All right, let's get some butter going here. Man, I'm starting to get the ChefShock sweats where I feel it all coming together and I'm getting really stoked. All right, that goes in the pan. That's gonna melt down. I don't know, that's like 2 TB or something. Let's just square this up so that I don't have to fight with anyone in the morning for why the butter is all over the map. Ta-da. And we'll throw this back in the fridge somewhere.
The Hippie is asking, do you like induction plates for cooking and baking, etc.?
I notoriously do not like induction. If you like induction, that's perfectly fine. I'm okay with that. It's just a personal thing. Like, for me, cooking on gas, like, I get immediate feedback from all of it. Pardon me. I think cooking on induction is a great idea. When you need to really control something, there's some really smart people that are making really smart, like, home cooking gadgetry where, like, I don't know, say you wanted to make the perfect omelet every time, you know, you can set it to, I don't know, 178 degrees or whatever the heck the perfect omelet temperature is, put it in, remove the omelet, and then it'll be like, green light, you know, it's this temperature, and it'll never get any higher or lower than that, it'll never waver. That's kind of cool. So it kind of combines the aspects of sous vide, but without the vacuum. In other words, it's precision temperature cooking, which is, scientifically, is a very good idea. Maybe we'll do it someday here, like make like a 64 degrees centigrade egg or something like that.
It's great for caramel.
Great for caramel. All right, fair enough. Someday I think I'm just gonna let Kelsey Pastry over here just take over the feed. I'm dead serious, because like, she can make really incredible stuff. You gotta try it, like.
I mean, pastry's fun, but it's a completely different thing than cooking. With this, you can be a lot more like, I feel like sriracha, I feel like fish sauce. Baking, a little less.
Well,
but I'd be down.
I admire your ability to bake stuff. Because I don't have it in me. Maybe someday I'll start making cupcakes and whatnot. Like, that's where I would start, probably. So what do you do here? Do you stream while you make your dinner, then you get off? Or do you have a stream schedule and have to make food during that time? So currently, we are Monday through Friday from 8 to 10. I make some dinner for everybody here to enjoy, if they're well-behaved, Ben. And then from there, we sit down and eat it. In a segment I like to call Let's Taste and Talk About Things. Here we go, panko. I don't know how much we're gonna need. I'm just adding that to the butter. While that's going,
DB Green's asking, will you be making food for SpaceX on their Mars mission?
I will not, although if you Google Justin Warner NASA, you'll be able to see, oh my God, look at that. You'll be able to see that I've actually hung out with an astronaut and made astronaut food with an astronaut before, which is pretty cool. Is Karen Nyberg was the astronaut. She was on the ISS for a long time. Great gal. Oh my God, that's so good. Why am I tasting this now? I'm tasting this now because I want to, you guessed it, adjust for salt with a salt pig. Because we're also going to want to season our crumb top.
Someone is asking, do you sharpen your own knives and how often do you sharpen them?
You know, I totally believe that this show, because it's all about realness and honesty and whatnot, I don't trust myself to sharpen my own knives. It's like, do you cut your own hair? You know, I leave it to a pro. Can I in a pinch? Sure. But in general, I would rather pay somebody and then I can hold them accountable. And then I don't get bummed out at myself when I screw things up. Should I learn? Yeah, probably. Do I understand the mechanics of it? Yes. Do I feel like investing in, like, you know, multiple grit stones and standing over them all night doing this? Nah, man, I got games to play. All right, so I added some salt to this. I'm gonna add some salt to our crumb top and I'm gonna turn off the heat on that. I'm gonna give this, oh man, that was beautiful. I'm gonna give this, everything's ruined. I'm gonna give this another little taste-a-roo.
JSmith74461 just actually sent in a question on a message that I think would benefit a lot of people, which is, on average, how long does it take to clean the kitchen after your meals, especially with making this many courses? That's their biggest anxiety with cooking.
Well, you know, in general, there's a rule that if you eat it, you know, if you cooked it, you don't have to do the dishes, but, you know, whatever. I'm adding some black pepper to this because black pepper rules. There's a little R2-D2 over here. Now I'm gonna sprinkle on some crumb top. And this guy's gonna go live in the oven. Oh man, this is gonna be delicious. I can't wait. Can't wait to start on those greens. And think about it, we're gonna be making some smoked jackfruit here next. We're actually gonna smoke the jackfruit like true barbecue style in our little kitchen here. Wait, did I answer that last question or did I just like move away? I did. It doesn't take me as long as you would think. It definitely takes less time than than making the food itself. But for me, this is part of the process. You know, I don't know why cleaning is an anxiety while I'm dealing with fire and knives and stuff like that. Cleaning is actually probably one of the most, I don't know, like approachable things about it. But you know, someday I think we'll just leave the stream on, you know, and you can just watch me clean, see how I clean, criticize the way that I load my dishwasher. My wife probably heard that. That was a reference from earlier today. 350 degree oven, the mac and cheese is going in. Is that gonna bake onto the side? Yes, so I'm gonna clean it up a little. All right, mac and cheese, you're powered up. Get in there. Oh man, that's gonna be so great. And that egg is just gonna thicken it all up nice and neat. Should probably clean that up because it's so unsightly. All right, let's check in with our greens and see how they're doing. Steamy, I bet. Stand back. Oh, you bet. Look at that, they're doing great. Let's scrub this guy off here. So we don't need a crumb topping in our greens. I'm just gonna keep giving these guys a stir, you know, and making sure that they're getting nice rotation around here. We're kind of like power steaming them right now. Towards the end of the cook, we're gonna season them up and we're gonna test them and taste them and see how good they are. I'm gonna be adding some acid to this and I might just add a pat more of butter if I feel like it. Drizzle of oil, who knows. The way I like to think about greens is like, you're kind of treating them as though they're a hot salad. You know, you want to kind of add like almost like a vinaigrette to them. We do that with almost any other leafy green. Why would you not have like basically a vinaigrette on your hot leafy greens? Make sense?
Absolutely.
All right. The moment you've all been waiting for, and that is, what are we going to do with this here jackfruit? And the answer is pretty simple. We're going to smoke it. How do you smoke in the home kitchen? Well, carefully and with the permission of your loved ones. If not, the authorities. We get some smoking chips. Now, I have oak. Someone tweeted me earlier today, what kind of wood chips should I use? What kind of barbecue sauce should I have? And these are all very deeply personal questions that you need to ask yourself and not me. I'm using oak because it's what I have. If I was in Texas, I probably wouldn't have oak. If I was in North Carolina, I probably wouldn't have oak. These are left over for a show where I was actually making a smoked salt with Mo Rocca to go on crabs. I'm originally from Maryland, and the state tree is oak, so I thought, you know, if it grows together, it goes together. I'm using oak. So, do whatever you want, basically. If there's something that your area is known for when it comes to smoke and barbecue and whatnot, by all means, be my guest. All right, so now we're gonna bring in kind of an interesting piece of equipment. This is what I call a cheap steamer pot. This is the kind of thing that sits up on top of the shelves at the supermarket, and you're like, why do they keep that up there? A lot of people will use these for seafood boils. Oh man, Dabs, Jen Limitless. Is that Jen Limitless? John Limitless. Thank you so much. You're keeping the lights on. All these lights. Oh my God. Look at that dab, it was amazing. The fish, not mine. I feel like a dab is, when it's amazing, that's something that someone else has to call you. You can't say my own dabs are so amazing. So why is this pot special? One, it's very cheap. It's made out of aluminum. It has a very annoying clatter. Ooh, doesn't that hurt? That's not giving your asthma stuff right now. And it has this steamer insert. You can see it's got this little ridge around here, and that I've used this guy a lot. This is one of my favorite pots to use. The steamer insert allows air to circulate. You can see that I just washed this for camera because it's like dripping. The steamer insert allows air to circulate. If you were gonna steam crabs or tamales or fish, you would fill it up just to this ridge with water, and then you would put all your other goods on top so that they're not getting waterlogged, they're getting steam blasted. So steam is basically water vapor. Smoke, on the other hand, while similar to steam, is actually solids. But I'm gonna use the same principle so that the solids circulate around and touch my jackfruit. That sounded profane, but I'm excited about it. So let's set up our smoker apparatus first.
Lady Sif wants to know, what kind of flavor does oak have or bring to the party?
I'm gonna read the back of it. Now, oak for me is like straight down the middle. It's not aggressive, aggressively like woody, like hickory or mesquite. It's not fruity like apple or cherry. I find oak is just like, sup, I'm wood. I'm here, you guys wanted wood. I came to the party, right? Can I smoke? Yes, that's why I use oak. Now I need some aluminum foil, which I got floating around down here. If you don't have a pot like this, don't fret. You can put almost anything down here that will just give you some elevation. If you've got a trivet that'll fit in a pot, as long as it's like heat proof, which if it's a trivet, it really should be, put the trivet in there, and then we're gonna make a little pouch. And the pouch is gonna live underneath of the jackfruit because we don't want the jackfruit to touch the heat source. We only want the wood to touch the heat source. So I'm gonna make a little papillote, if you're fancy. Basically just a little parcel of wood chips that we're gonna put on the bottom. And then when we heat this pan up, just like we were vaporizing something, all of this is going to smolder. And so oxygen is not good. Oxygen will make flame, not smoke. So I really wanna kinda wrap this up nice and tight. I don't know how much I'm using there. The answer, some. I'm gonna wrap this up nice and tight. And we're gonna put them in the bottom of our pan. And then we're gonna drain the jackfruit and talk about jackfruit and talk about smoking. I'm really excited about this. I personally know it's dangerous, but you can actually see, you wanna go up there? I've actually disabled my smoke alarm for when I do this show and when I'm cooking. If you're sensitive to noise or your alarms are specifically sensitive. Oh my God, Anonymous, thank you. Thank you so much for keeping the lights on. And thanks also for keeping the smoke alarms on. I would never tell anyone ever to disable their smoke alarm. It's a very dangerous and bad idea. But when you're making a live show like this, the last thing you want is for the smoke alarm to go off. And that is entirely possible. We're just gonna have to deal. Yeah, that is dinged. Ding, that is dangerous AF. But that's why I told you not to do it. I've done it because, well, I don't really care that much.
I mean, talking about a different kind of heat, Wampa 12 is saying, do you like ghost peppers or anything really spicy?
You know, I'm all for like exploring every facet of gastronomy and culinaria, but peppers that are that hot to me, like I'll chase a good heat buzz. Like don't get me wrong. Like I love the endorphin rush of heat. I love it to death. But what I don't really love is like putting myself in great discomfort, because to me, you know, as I said earlier, it's called the joy of cooking, not the intense discomfort of cooking. But you know, to each his own. You know what I mean? We've all got our own little tics and masochisms and whatnot. You know, myself personally, I like to, I don't know, I like to get in front of a bunch of people and ramble and cook, which, you know, that's a little painful to some other people. Public speaking is a huge fear. So maybe I'm just scared, I guess, of that intense heat of the ghost pepper. But also, yeah, I don't know. I'm not afraid of heat. I'll drink sriracha. You know, that to me is like nothing. That's like baseline. I know that my mentor, Alton Brown, hates sriracha, but I feel bad for that poor guy because he's had to eat so much of it where chefs just, they don't even integrate it in the dish. They put it on the plate and they're like, I made a sauce. You didn't make a sauce, son. Get that out of here. Oh my gosh.
Everybody is worrying for the stuffed animals before the smoking. They don't want a smoky Kirby, an after hours Kirby.
That's really sweet. So, all right, we'll get these guys. You know damn well that KK, when he's DJ KK, you know he's been in a smoky club before. But thank you for looking out. You know, they're all white, and I would actually get nervous that they would get gray and burn. That would be lame. Oh, hey, look. Oh, Ben, I'm never bored, man. Ben's like DMing me in the Google chat. He's like, hey, I sent you some messages of people who have subscribed. Read them out if you get bored. Ben, I'm never bored, man. Look at this show. Astronaut, thank you. Thank you for using bits and cheering. Mission Nakara, thank you. Mission Nakara, also, you've helped me so much on Twitter getting people that are like not in this whole field accustomed to the Twitch. Thank you for that help. That's been really amazing. Gosh darn it, Ben, now look what happened.
Rad Overlord has said, what's your favorite snack that's fast and easy?
Favorite snack that's fast and easy? Cheese? I like, oh, cheese. that really annoys people. You'll not make any friends like that, but that's okay. So look, let's look at this jackfruit. This jackfruit has become like already shredded. I got some really good jackfruit. It looks like albacore tuna, doesn't it? And that's like another LaRJK. Thank you for subscribing, bro. If you're the RJK, I know. Thank you. So yeah, it looks like tuna, and I love making these in fish sticks. If you want to get kind of close there so you can see. Doesn't it just look like albacore, right? Taste, a little sour, a whisper of mango, but not too much. It's like it looked at the mango and it was like, oh, hey, what's up? I acknowledge you. Other than that, I'm kind of neutral.
And if someone wanted to learn how to make jackfruit fish sticks, where could they maybe find a recipe?
That was amazing. If you wanted to find a jackfruit fish stick, you'd have to purchase this book over here, which is called The Laws of Cooking and How to Break Them. But, you know, if you're a subscriber, there might be an opportunity, say, like later in the stream or next week, rather, where I might be able to talk to my publishers and make them give you books because I asked politely. Audrinus, Pterodactyl, Rusterus, Zuru Parai, Tuna and Rice, Tab 8226, Ender, Kellyanne Fisher, Shoemaker, 3317, Jazz, Malang, George, Suki. Thank you for subscribing. I'm gonna get a bowl over here because I got all sorts of like dirty dishes in this sink. And I'm gonna need a bowl to mix this up later. So I'm gonna drain the jackfruit from its brine. Here's kind of what it looks like when it's whole. What they've done, this is a great jackfruit company. They came in and they removed the big, they're kind of like seeds, wouldn't you say? But they're not really seeds. I don't know. Norman, too, thank you for subscribing. You're dope.
Lady Astolat says, can you do this with fresh jackfruit or do you prefer canned?
I prefer canned jackfruit because that's the only method that I've tested. And I don't know. Like, for this application, I enjoy a pre-cooked shelf-stable product. But if somebody wants me to try it with regular jackfruit, I don't know, maybe I'll go buy one and try it out. We'll see. But yeah, in general, I like it like this.
And lovely Lana's asking, what's the brine for the jackfruit and the canned one?
Organic lime juice, sea salt, and water. How about them apples? So yeah, I got like the really good brand. Normally I get the stuff that's like calcium sorbate and other weird stuff. But anyway, this jackfruit is super tender and super wet, and because of the salt in this, just like when you're making normal barbecue and you rub salt on the outside, it's gonna be a really great method for absorbing the smoke that we're gonna create. And I'm really stoked about that. And so we got all this brine out of here. I'm not gonna use this brine for anything. I don't even know what I would use it for. It might be good in a martini, actually. Like in a dirty martini, a dirty jackfruit martini.
Like a Caribbean martini?
Yeah, right?
Heck yeah.
Wow, you hear that gentle whistle?
Say, and I'm really stoked Cubs are up 3-1.
Cubs are up 3-1? Are you serious? I'm not a fan of anything, but that's almost like dad worthy. Like, go Cubs,
well,
go.
Well, you know, the Cubs kept scoring when you kept getting dabs. I didn't want to jinx it if we have any Indians fans on there, because, you know, much respect, but...
I mean, it's a big deal. I've got a lot of friends and fans that this would mean so much to them for the Cubs, so... I don't know. I always like root for the underdog. All right, so I've got this nice and drained. I've got this ready to rock over here. What we're gonna do is add some tofu to the mix. I know. I'm sure we're gonna get some eye rolls and whatnot. That's perfectly fine. Because I like tofu in this, and the reason I like tofu in this is because tofu also absorbs smoke really well. And when I'm making a pulled pork, like a real pulled pork, when you actually pull the pork, there are two kinds of meat. There's like muscular fiber, and then there is this kind of like really supple, rich stuff that tastes totally delicious. Some people call that fat. And I find that the texture of tofu kind of mimics that fattiness. You know, when you bite into an animal, you're biting into all sorts of parts. And I feel like that's one problem with a lot of vegetarian substitutes or alternatives, is that they're all very one note, one texture. You know, you might be lucky if, like, in a veggie patty, you find a couple of beans, you know, or some corn or something like that. Whatevs. I'm gonna use half of this block of firm tofu. I'm gonna give it just a little press there, just to get out a little excess water. I actually have a tofu press. It's kind of a unitasker, but it makes good pickles too, actually. Oh well. All right, tofu's been pressed.
If you were to have just one type of tofu on hand, what would you go for? Medium, super firm?
For me, it's medium firm, the best of all worlds, you know? You can blend that up and it'll be all right. I used half a block of tofu, and I used 4 cans of jackfruit. Now, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it's time to smoke them if you got them. And we got them.
Now, the Noah Geiger's asking, what would your perfect sandwich be?
Oof, that's a really difficult question. I don't know, I think my favorite sandwich is a BLT. I had not planned on putting this colander in here, but that's gonna work awesome. So we're almost approaching done here. All I really have to do is make sure that this continues to steam, or to smoke rather, and then we'll check on some of our other stuff and we'll take questions. This is gonna take, I don't know, 10 or 15 minutes. You know, this isn't like a really a heavy smoke. 10 or 15 minutes, man, the time's flying by. I gotta get on this, huh? Crud. So I'm just gonna kind of seal this up over here with a little fall. Man, time really flies when everybody's donating and dabbing and stuff. And we're at that special time of the night where my mise en place is like totally gone from everywhere, and it feels really good. Now already, you can kind of see, we've got a little smokage. Oh, maybe that's from the bottom of the pot. It's because there was schmutz on the bottom of the pot. Don't worry about it, I meant to do that. Anybody growing up, did you ever watch Eureka's Castle and that bat flies into the wall and it says, I meant to do that. Okay. Huh? Oh my gosh. Fluffinutta, love the handle. Thank you for keeping the lights on. I really appreciate it. Gosh, that makes my day. Man, I'm serious, like I leave this stream and all I want to do is like run out and hug humanity. Which is disturbing because, like, I don't know, like 2 weeks ago I would be probably one of the last people. I'm sorry?
No, I was gonna be playing myself the same one.
Oh. Alright. So look, we're gonna work on our greens while this does its thing. The greens, almost all the liquid is gone. That's a very good thing. Because we don't need a ton of liquid in there. We mostly need them to be tasty and seasoned. So I'm going to wash these off, give this a little stir, and see where we're at. Oh my goodness. Almost all that liquid is absorbed. You'll see that the onions are completely translucent. And let's test and see if these are tender. I can tell you already they're tender. Look, I can just like mash this with my fingers. Whoa. So tender. Just the right amount of heat. Of course, it's gonna need salt. And we're gonna need some acid. Acid in the form of lemon juice. But I like to take that off the heat when I add the lemon juice because I don't really like, dude, I like the mask. Smoking! There was this little kid that, I guess his dad owned a car dealership or something like that. And so they put this poor little kid up to making the advertisements for the car dealership. And so this like 4-year-old got up, and this was like the time when like Jim Carrey and the mask was like the most epic thing ever. And the deals at the car dealership were, smoking. And anytime I smoke something, I think of that kid and like, where is he now? The poor smoking kid. So yeah, we're literally smoking here. And you can actually see this is not a ton of smoke. It's not like smoking up the whole apartment. Everything's gonna be okay. But given that we're keeping it contained in here, that's gonna really do the job. I'm gonna open it up, see what we're looking at, and now, I'm probably gonna give the jackfruit a toss.
Jawa Rison's asking, is there an alternative to smoking if that's not an option at the moment?
Absolutely. You could use liquid smoke if you want. You could, if you got a vacuum sealer or a whipped cream container, you could wad all this stuff in there, and then from there, you could kind of like pressure smoke with liquid smoke. Liquid smoke to me does not have the most authentic smoky flavor, but I've had perfectly serviceable things that I might have said were barbecue that were made with liquid smoke, so have at it. The reason I say a vacuum sealer or a, what do you call this thing? The whipped cream canister?
ISI whip?
Yeah, the ISI whip. That's a brand though, and they don't pay us to say it.
Nope.
You can pressurize, and by making a vacuum, you can kind of speed inject the liquid smoke. One of my main problems with liquid smoke is that, you know, unless that liquid smoke is fully integrated in every part of it, it's so like potent that it, oh my God. Ender, thank you, my dude. Oh my goodness. Look at these dabs, man. We're gonna make this fish famous by the end of this stream. Anyway, it's so potent, it's like a WMD, man, and you can't let that fall in the hands of the clumsy. So if I were to put just a little dab of liquid smoke onto this, I might have one bite that is just like a complete smoke meltdown, and then the other bite could be, well, nothing. And that would be a real bummer.
Have you ever tried the Lapsang smoked tea? I find that if you put that in a marinade, it doesn't have like the tannic tea flavors, but it has been smoked, so it brings a more natural smoke into it.
What brilliant person's asking that question?
No, that was just, I'm suggesting that in place of
wow.
In place of liquid smoke.
We sure know how to have friends and hire around here, I tell you what. No, I've never done that, but I think that's actually a great idea, and I think I'm gonna add that to my repertoire of, like, I call these things, they're not cheating, but it's like a cheat, you know, in order to get smoke in. So, like, when you're on these, like, crazy cooking shows, and you're like, all right, how am I gonna make a barbecue dish using chocolate in XYZ minutes? I'll probably throw in some of that Lapsang tea. That's a good idea.
It was the number one secret we had at the vegan restaurant to make things taste meaty.
Oh, really?
Yep.
Dude, I'm into it. So you've worked at a vegan restaurant, Kelsey?
A vegan raw restaurant.
And I love you. my respect for you has gone up tenfold. All right, this is still smoking. Little whispers of it, not as intense as it was before. This guy is almost done. Let's take a peek at our good friend mac and cheese. And that guy is looking delicious, bubbly, golden brown on top. Oh, let's get a trivet for it so that it can do its thing. You got a trivet laying around here?
Yep, we do.
I don't know, maybe I could stand to blast that mac and cheese a little bit more under the broiler, but I'm gonna save that for another show because I think this looks freaking epic. Look at that, you see how it's not sliding around? That's a good sign, we're killing it.
And Rad Overlord is asking, do you prefer to cook on a barbecue or indoors on a stove?
I'm a barbecue fanatic, man. I have two smokers. I have three smokers, actually. I did some development work for a company that makes electronic smokers, and let me tell you, I love smoking. I'm gonna zest just a little bit of this lemon to give some of the aromatic citrus oil notes to these greens. I'm gonna do it with my scrapey. I guess I thought I was done. Well, oh, there it is. It's got cheese all over it. Forget it. What a bummer. Ruined. Lemon zest is gonna go in there.
Drago the Dragon 1 is asking, why did you choose the name ChefShock?
Oh, I chose the name ChefShock because there have been a lot of food shows, and so almost every permutation of cooking and chefing has been taken. And so I just thought about the concept. What do I want it to be? I want it to be a shock. You know, not an electrocution, but just, like, I want food television to get, like, a little rattled from this. And that's where we are. I'm gonna add some lemon juice to finish these guys. Just a little. Maybe, like, I don't know, 3/4 of 1/2. Do the math on that, you old geniuses. I'm gonna let the mac and cheese rest so that, just like a meat thing, so that it's not gushing everywhere. I'm gonna add a little more salt from the salt pig. I can't see the chat anymore, but.
Everyone loves the salt pig.
Everyone loves the salt pig, that's the best. He's my best friend. I think if we get enough subscribers, we're gonna make a salt pig emote, which is gonna be great. I'm really excited about that. Because the salt pig deserves the fame. I'm just gonna let these chill out and kind of rest for a little bit. I'm gonna take a little taste and see if I've added enough salt and acid to the mix. Oh my God. You're darn tootin' we have.
Now, if you're going to be smoking this on the stovetop, are you using a different type of wood chip than you would on an actual barbecue? Aren't they smaller?
Yes, that's true. I'm using wood shavings, which, you know, you could use that if you've ever seen any of these shows, chefs using a smoking gun. Yeah, I'm using basically what I would use in a smoking gun. But right now, that's different than the stuff that I would put in my electric smoker and yada yada. All right, so it looks like our smoking has come to not a halt, but we do have to eat at some point, right? But let's take a whiff. It's definitely starting to smell like campfire in here. The lights that we use to light the place are starting to, still smoking. The lights that we use are starting to have a little glaze over them. And let's have a taste. You can see, maybe it's difficult to see. Oh my God, Huddy's Bebop. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. If you like Huddy's, man, I got one of your favorite musicians here, Max Rebo. Oh my God, I just tasted that little bit. I was kind of interrupted by the dab, which interrupt me all you want. You can kind of see that this tofu is now warmed, and right around the outside, it's got just a brown sheen to it. And that brown sheen, oh my goodness, is smoke. We are almost done, my friends, coming down the home stretch. This thing got shockingly hot. So we'll take it out over here. Oh yeah. I'm gonna shake this up. I'm gonna transfer this to another pot simply because I don't want to dirty another bowl. And the great thing, one of the great things actually about cooking vegetarian stuff is because you don't have to worry about cross-contamination. Yeah, you're good to go. So how do we turn this into barbecue? We add a little fat in the form of peanut oil. If you're allergic to peanuts, use any other oil you want. It's perfectly fine. I just love peanut oil and its nutty flavors. It kind of, I feel like maybe I'm crazy, like maybe I'm like having synesthesia right now, but I really just feel like pork is nutty. I feel like, you know, the finest hams are fed on chestnuts, correct?
And acorns, yep.
Yeah, chestnuts and acorns, and so I don't know, I just feel like maybe that's the South in me talking, but why do they make everything so difficult? Tell you what, man, I sound like an old man, but rappers bug me. Especially fake rappers. That was so dumb. All right, so what the peanut oil is gonna do is add some nuttiness, but it's also gonna add some, you guessed it, fat. I think the problem with a lot of vegetarian analogs is that there's not enough fat in the equation where we eat it and we feel calorically empty. We might be full this way, but we're not full like this way, you know? Not that I'm a shrink or anything like that. A nice healthy dose of that. We're good there. Let's grab some barbecue sauce. Maybe I got some up here. I don't know. Yeah, I do. Sweet baby Ray's, this sauce is a boss.
Winsome is asking, do you have any favorite food blogs?
Yeah, I do. I've got you might check my Twitter and just like see who I follow, because it's a lot. But I really love this gal Molly who does My Name Is Yeh, Y-E-H, or Yeh. I've never met her in person because she's a blogger, you know? Actually, she invited me to her book party and I didn't go. But anyway, yeah, man, she kills it. There's another one called I Am a Food Blog. They made these really ridiculous Totoro. I don't know if you've ever seen that flick Totoro, but they made these really cute little Totoro. What do you call it?
Like, is it the steam buns that she did on the Totoro?
You know who I'm talking about, right?
I know, I Am a Food Blog because they won the Savour Best Blog this past year. But the Totoro buns and rice balls have taken over Instagram because Studio Ghibli for life.
Yeah, right? All right. All right, this guy is just hovering at about room temperature. I'm going to hit it with just a little more barbecue sauce. And then I'm going to throw it very quickly on the stove just to warm it. In my opinion, barbecue should not be served hot. It should be served warm. And now that we got all this stuff coming together, we're going to roll this up into a burrito and devour it. How does everybody feel about that?
Sounds fantastic.
Fluffinetta, thank you for subscribing. I love that handle. I'm actually going to be using marshmallow fluff, tomorrow, right? We're going to use marshmallow fluff on some sweet potatoes.
That we are?
Yes, we are. Let's give this a taste, the sanitary taste. Bro, game over. GG, everybody. EZ. Man, it's so reminiscent. I'm going to add just a little more oil and a little more salt. It's so reminiscent of pulled pork to me that, I don't know, you'd have to be a real carnivore to understand that there's a difference going on there. If I just blinded somebody on that, they'd be like, sick barbecue, dude. I want to get a little spoon going. I can use those tongs. All right, we're just going to add this to the heat. While we're doing that, I'm going to warm these guys back up. They're probably still plenty warm. And I'm going to plug in the microwave. Jesus, guess what I just did? I melted the tortillas to the pan. Live television, everybody. Oh, well. I meant to do that because I wanted to open it, you see. I was just preparing for the next step in my run of show. All right, so we got two people eating tonight. So I'm going to plug that mic back in. The microwave, not the microphone. Man, this is one of the longest ones we've done. I didn't realize it was going to take this long. I feel like I'm behind schedule because I'm not done at 9:30. Let's plug this guy back in. Reaching myself over the dangerous flames. Recalibrate this. There's that dumb fan. Oh, shut up. It complains if it spends too much time off. I feel like this microwave is like my Neopet or something. Nanopet? Gigapet? I don't know. It feels like a Tamagotchi. It complains. So I just hit those tortillas for like 15 seconds just to wake them up and let them know it's about time to shine.
John Limitless asks, what do you think about seasoning salts and do you have a favorite you like to use?
Seasoning salts? That's a good question. In general, my favorite that I like to use is one that I've made myself. Adding, say, salt or a lemon zest to salt is a great way to make a lemony salt. You add pepper to it, and now you've got lemon pepper salt. So I'm into it. I'm a Marylander, so I love J.O. Spice, which is kind of like the indie version of Old Bay. I love that stuff. They actually made me this sick cutting board with my head on it. Check that out. If you want one, just call J.O. Spice up and get it. That was from my show Foodie Call we used to do back in the day.
And Jubilee is actually asking, do you have any must-eat restaurants in Maryland that you recommend?
You know, that dude Voltaggio has some good places. And honestly, I've only been to D.C. in the past couple of relevant time frames. So, I don't know, your guess is kind of as good as mine. But that whole area right now, I did some, reading. Not that I care, but I heard that there are more millennials, wealthy millennials in that area than anywhere else. And so that means, you know, it's like where there are wealthy millennials, there is food. Oh man, this is gonna be the absolute best. All right, we've got this guy up to temp here. And that's really starting to look like pulled pork. If you wanna get in there, you can see, that looks like pulled pork. If I wanted, man, I could crisp this up a little and maybe make some mock burnt ends, but I'm not going to. Let's get one more trivet out, shall we? Oh, I'll just use this towel, who cares? I should have cleaned up more. I don't know, I've been so excited about this. I just get in the zone and I'm like, whatever. No one cares, right? Is anybody actually judging me because I didn't put away the panko? Oh boy. I bet you're also bummed out that I didn't seal the bag. It might go stale. Nah, I'll use those and something else. This looks amazing. All right, let's get out our special spoon. Did I throw it in here? Where did a special spoon go? Is anybody else keeping tabs on the special spoon? We'll get that nice and clean.
Yeah, it was called out for not being washed. You're like, you'll need that later.
Oh, really?
Yep. Oh, yeah.
Wow, man.
Your stream does not miss a thing.
Y'all are paying attention, man. That's great. All right, here we go. So first, we're going to add the mac and cheese. Oh, man, this is going to be so delicious. First, we're going to add the mac and cheese. Why the mac and cheese first? Because it's the gooeyest, cheesiest, wonderful thing. Look at that. Remember how sloppy it was before, and now it's just all holding together in one cheesy mass? Still has so much heat in it, even though it's been off the heat for a long time. So this is gonna be kind of like our goo to keep everything together. Now we'll add some of our pulled pork. Hey, thank you for cheering. I'm really excited about it. And now we'll add some of our greens. Some people are gonna be like, oh, why didn't you make a sauce? Like, you know, you gotta have a dippy thing for the burrito. Yeah, I guess I could have. But to be honest, you see how wet and moist and lovely those greens are? And let's taste it. I didn't even taste after I seasoned it. I just know it's right there. It's so acidic and lively and bright.
Not bitter at all.
Do you guys know how to roll a burrito? If you don't. Actually, when I was buying a bunch of these amiibos, I met this dude, Matt. He became kind of like my amiibo dealer. Like he lived in Long Island, so he always had access to Toys R Us and stuff. And Matt is a Chipotle manager, so we vibed on like how to burrito roll. All right, so first we fold in here, right? Then we roll up here, and then you crunch it down like so. You really gotta crunch and pull and concentrate. Oh, damn, fired. It's ruined, everybody. It's ruined.
Yeah, but it's 5-1 Cubs, so we got that going for us.
All right, dope. Maybe I overloaded that one. I don't care. I don't work at Chipotle. That's ruined. I'm still gonna eat it. It'll be great. All right, so let's do the other one, and hopefully we don't ruin it. Is there fail fish going on, this guy, you know? Is there a lot of fail going on in the stream?
We got some ruins, you know, but...
Whatevs, man. Yeah. When was the last time you had a mac and cheese burrito? I think that's what's ruined, that you haven't had a mac and cheese burrito before.
If anything, you're just fixing everyone's life right now.
I hope so. All right, now a little bit of our pulled pork. Man, my wife is gonna be so happy about this because she absolutely loves this. This is like the ultimate grab and go in the morning. You can freeze these in their natural state, just like this. Wrap them up in like plastic and freeze them. And then from there, you can just nuke them in the morning and you are good to go. These hold up really well. The flavors stay nice and co-mingled.
And you know, if you're a big fan of camping, frozen burritos are way better than ice packs because ice packs melt out and take up space.
Now you know. That was dope. Great job. And they laughed at me. They laughed at me. That could be tucked a little more. Let's tuck it a little more. Look at that. That, my friends, is a Soulrito. I guess all we have to do now is devour these. Kelsey, are you ready?
Absolutely.
Beautiful.
Ready.
Well, first things first, you want something to drink?
Yeah, sure.
Great answer.
Yeah.
After last night with the fun that we had with the Sambuca, I'm just gonna keep myself a little cup there, and we'll close in on it soon. Just keep yourself a little cup there. What do you want? We're having Southern food. You wanna have a whiskey with me?
Absolutely, like, or a bourbon, or whatever you
got. I got a Tennessee whiskey. Is that good enough?
Absolutely.
Classy lady wants to have some bourbon, but I'm too cheap.
Well, you know, when the mercury drops, you gotta go for the whiskey.
Right? I can tell you, the mercury ain't dropping here.
No,
so we
not.
Did some research last night. You know, this is normally when we taste and talk about things. We did some research, and we found out that if I take a bite of the food, everyone leaves. And as we all know, if you leave, well, that ain't gonna keep the lights on. So, you know, who knows? I'm gonna set this table right now. We'll get a camera on me here in just one sec.
Finter wants to know, how long do you microwave them for after they've been frozen?
I would simply take a test yourself, put a cake tester or a paper clip in the center of it, and when you can pull that out and it feels warm on your skin, that would be when it's done. Who am I looking at? This guy? Still? Look, Jibanyan kept falling off last night, so I replaced him with the Pikachu that sits on your shoulder, the weighted one. But yeah, anyway, he's got... I had to disable his talking thing. All right, we're trying to get cameras repositioned. And it's real hot here. I gotta turn off this. We're done there. Oh, man. So I guess the next question about these burritos is, can we make a chimichanga? Can we make a vegan chimichanga? And guess what? The second you thought of that, whoever you were who thought, man, I'd love to make a vegan chimichanga, this makes a sick, did I say vegan? Whatever. This makes a sick vegetarian chimichanga. All you gotta do is put the seam side down in oil, seal that seams. Hey, thank you for hosting. Put that seam side down in hot oil, and then you fry it, and then you turn it, and then you call it a day. Who's excited? All right, I'm sure we got some questions that I just like glossed over.
Oh yeah, we've got some that I've saved.
I'm having scotch.
What are the three smokers that you have?
Oh, great question. I have two Masterbuilt electric smokers. Who am I talking to? I'm still talking to this guy. Can you switch it to this guy? Am I? That's it. I have two Masterbuilt electric smokers. They work really well for me. It's very difficult to get propane in New York. Because we live so closely to schools, there's something about you can't vend it XYZ close to a school, so that kind of bums me out. But I use their electrics, and their electrics actually work just fine for me. I've made barbecue for like the New York City Wine and Food Festival that people have like completely lost their mind over. Thanks for hosting, Geek Cat Yoshi, you're the best. We were hanging out in the food chat earlier today, because I was it today or yesterday? I don't know, it's all blurring together. And then I have just like what I call like a crappy offset that I got for like $90 on special at the hardware store. And it works fine. I like to do that like late summer when I've got nothing to do and I want to tend a fire all day. I don't know, there's this like critter inside of me that just wants to tend a fire every now and then. And I don't know, it smells good, feels good, you can hang out, you can drink.
I think living in the city can definitely bring that out in anybody.
Right?
Yeah.
If anybody's curious about Masterbuilt Smokers, thank you for hosting. Their Twitter presence is really great, but their Facebook is nuts. Send a message to like My Masterbuilt Smoker, the Facebook group, and that's a really supportive community. And even better, if you tell them I sent you, they'll be really happy about that.
And Shade and Shadow says, have you ever used a Traeger smoker?
You know, I haven't used a Traeger smoker, but I know a lot of people have, and people seem to swear up and down by it. That's perfectly fine by me. But you know, I don't know. I just haven't, they didn't give me one.
And Nom Bread, I know it's the vegetarian Vednesday, asks, have you ever cooked deer or buffalo before?
I've cooked both before. Apparently I'm butt dialing all my friends while I cook. Whatevs. But yeah, I've cooked venison plenty of times. Venison, hey, thanks dude. Now I can follow in the chat, even better. I'll tell you what, it's great having people on your team. I've cooked venison many times. I love to crust it with cocoa, and no, my wife plays that ukulele, not I. I like to brush venison with cocoa and do it with like a fruit sauce, you know, just like it's sick, like
that
medium rare. I always feel like I'm getting, they call it backstrap, but it's actually like the tenderloin of the venison. But yeah, poaching that with a little cocoa rub on it, you sear it, and then you slow poach it in butter, like...
You say venison works kind of like duck, plays with the same flavors a lot of times?
Yeah, definitely, definitely. You know, it's a meat that I think duck is good when it's got a little red in it. Mm-hmm. And it's super. So yeah, I love that. And I've made a buffalo burger. I think that recipe's still floating around on the internet, but I made a buffalo burger, and then I actually made... like a fried dough to work as the bread. That was sick. You know, the one thing with buffalo is it's so lean, you really need to add some fat. Some people are against that, some people are pro that. If I could actually just buy buffalo tallow, if that even exists.
Probably in Italy.
Right? I would kill to have buffalo tallow and just augment that back into the beef, but I don't know, or back into the buff. But yeah, people, oh, you think it's getting cold? Well, you see, we did some investigating. And we realize that if I take a bite of this food, then people will walk away. And that's not gonna keep the lights on. But let's have a bite, shall we? And
Absolutely.
Then let's watch the amount of eyeballs just completely drop.
It hasn't dropped yet.
It hasn't dropped yet. See? Because I haven't touched the food.
And while we bite, you could think Bone Hugs and Romany said, your cookbook's all about flavor combos. What other combos make a perfect veg burrito?
Oh, what other combos make a perfect veg burrito? That's a great question. You've obviously read my book or at least checked it out. You know, I think you really, in all vegetarian cooking, you really need a mix of like fresh, rich, and je ne sais quoi. You know, I think that a surprising element, like say, smoke, is crucial in all of this. And you think so?
It adds a lot of depth. It adds that meaty flavor, which I hate when vegetarian food is just trying to be meat.
Yeah.
But I think that it gives a lot of depth that sometimes vegetables don't have on their own.
All right.
Just in the promising to stay.
Yeah.
All right, here we go. It's still really hot. It's hot, right?
It feels great.
All right, here we go. I'm gonna take this corner bite and see how it goes. Ready? Yeah, get on that guy, ready? Mm. Right? It's that soul food silence.
Oh my goodness.
Where you just had everything at once.
Mm-hmm.
And you're like, man, is that pork in there? Is this like a, honestly, this is like a super porky cheesy burrito and there's no pork
it's
in it.
It's like Thanksgiving in the South.
Mm-hmm.
In a burrito.
Look, everybody's out. See ya. Time to leave, boys. Wrap it up. GG, everybody. Oh, easy. Oh, man. Oh man, it's so good.
It is so good.
And look, you gotta love it when you bite into a burrito and there's just like an elbow mac just popping out there, right?
Cheers.
Yeah, here's to it, huh? I'm drinking a smoky scotch right now. What am I drinking, Talisker? Yeah, pardon me, the Talisker.
And actually, Hootes Bebop said, what's your favorite beer?
What I got on tap here, I'm not gonna say any beer specific brands, but what I have on tap here is very inexpensive, very light, very unsophisticated. And that's, you know, Daddy Goldblum, I'm gonna marry this burrito. I'm a beer drinker and I understand the great beers. Like I live right next door to a great beer bar called The Wilkie. If you're ever in New York, come look it up. I might be passed out in front of it. And so I get it, but when I'm at home, man, I really just want like mildly malted alcoholic carbonated water. Mm-hmm. And so that's what I got. If I had to pick a brewery of all time and a beer of all time, that would be New Belgium Brewery's Abbey Ale. That thing I love it. It's like my favorite book, you know what I mean? It's got so much character to it. I wrote a recipe based off of my love for its banana and clove notes. Oddly enough, banana and clove are actually, their scent is actually composed of a similar scent molecule.
Thank you, Chemos.
Thank you, Chemos, yeah, right? Chemos is like this online blog where you can basically cheat and learn everything very fast, right?
Mm-hmm. And again, it goes back to that what grows together goes together.
It's totally true. You know, where a lot of cloves are made, right around the, what do you call that thing? The equator, in warm climates. Is that Scotch at Talisker 25? No, that's Talisker 10, man. You're not keeping the lights on that well. So anyway, Ghost Override, you like their watermelon. Yeah, New Belgium's watermelon is really good. I forget what that thing is called. Who knows? Anyway, that was a good one. I'm sure you got another one.
And now, Black to the Dome says, what's your favorite cutting board and why is it the booze block?
What's my favorite cutting board and why is it the booze block? Well, you know what? Maybe we can leak this right now. We can leak it. Producers, can I leak it? Booze block is absolutely my favorite cutting board, and that's because it's easy to clean, it's super hard, it looks good, it's maple, and it's just like the industry standard. Like it's not just the standard, it's the best. And they absolutely do not pay me to say that, but they could be paying you to have me say that, because tomorrow night,
you're paid in.
Yeah, it's not like I'm paid in money. You know, they might throw me a cutting board every now and then, but that's because I ask politely. And I'm like, hey, I'll throw it on my show because I love it. Tomorrow at the end of the stream, if you are subscribed at the end of that stream, we'll cut it off. And then we're going to do some crazy RNG stuff, so no complaints. I swear to God, I'm going to get out an RNG app. And whatever RNG that picks, we will mail you, I'm not kidding you, like a 20-pound block of wood. I just guesstimated on that. It's probably like 10 or 15. Courtesy of Booze Block. How about that? I know. Cutting boards are actually costly. They are really costly. So yeah, this is like a serious sellout. I'm selling out for you, Ashoka. You could be the winner, but I see that you don't have a gold pot next to your name, do you? So if you want an opportunity to snag one of those, yeah, you might consider being subscribed. Oh yeah, and like if you've got Twitch Prime, for example, like if you wanted to get that jackfruit in 2 days with no shipping, not a sellout, just straight logistics. If you wanted that, you could give us your Twitch Prime subscription, and we would be thrilled about that. Can you guys tell that, like, I can talk about food all day, but in terms of like generating usership, thank you for subscribing, Diatheus. I don't know, man. Like, I'm just not about the hard sell, you know.
I get that, but I think, I mean, people are going to come here for the information, and I think you're giving that to them, so we have a couple of questions that people did want to know. Jay Smoner, Smon-Ater, I'm not sure. What brand do you like for Hispanic products like tortillas, chips, etc.?
For me, it's always about local. There's a great place here in New York called Chinantla, or Torteria, I can never say that word, Tortilleria Los Hermanos, thank you for cheering. You know, and these are like family-owned businesses, so I just go with like whatever is closest by proximity. I think Chinantla's on Grand here in Brooklyn, and then I think Tortilleria Hermanos is over there on, what, like Star and Wyckoff in Bushwick. So depending on where I am between those two locations, that's where I get my tortillas.
And Misha Nicara says, do you have to be in the chat at the time if they're going to be stuck at work? And I recognize his name. They have been here.
Yeah, they have been here. No. If you are subscribed at the end of tomorrow's stream, we'll get a hold of you one way, shape, or form. Hey, Bradley D. Hobbs, thanks for throwing us that Twitch Prime subscription. Great job. Yeah, if you're subscribed, you don't have to be present. We'll just make sure my people get a hold of you and the Booze Block Company as well. You know what? Roll that beautiful wood footage. They did not pay me to show you that, but it just makes me really happy. They've worked with me before. Oh, shoot. Maybe I shouldn't do that. They've worked with me in the past before just in order to outfit kitchens for shoots, you know? It's actually, I mean, you can say sellout, whatever you want. That's perfectly fine. But, for me, what they're doing by giving me a cutting board to use on this show, they're increasing everybody's ability to be more learned and more excited about cooking. And I had this mentor at one time, not to get all like Zenyatta on you, but I had this mentor, Danny Meyer. I learned a lot from him. He's got a great book as well. But he says the rising tide lifts all boats. And so the idea is if my tide rises because I got a cool cutting board, maybe your tide will rise as well because I can do this on a beautiful cutting board. Does that make sense?
Now, I know the wood cutting boards intimidate some people because they think they can't put raw meat and stuff like that on there, but you want to address that? That's something that's come up.
I don't know. Personally, I sanitize and I season. I rub that thing with mineral oil. I'll use the sanitizing soap on it. Then I'll rub it with mineral oil again. I don't know, man. This board is so hard. It doesn't get weird grooves in it. And for me, that's the part that you really got to be nervous about is when you get really weird grooves. These boards are also totally, totally reversible. So I don't know if you noticed, but I always work like in one corner, then I'll rotate, then I'll flip, then I'll rotate. It's like keeping a mattress. The grooves are what you gotta get nervous about. Once, like on a silicone board, when you get like weird cut marks in there, you can leave meat in there. It could stay for a day or two and whoo.
Fog City Roller asks, do you think foodie culture and Yelp has had a negative impact on the restaurant industry and
Man.
Intimidates people from opening new spots?
What is this, 2020? I'm gonna let everybody know that I'm here. Hi, everyone. I'm actually not ChefShock. ChefShock is my show. I'm Justin Warner, and I am Eat Fellow Humans. Justin Warner here. Sorry, we were unable to connect to the chat. What happened? Reconnecting. Whatever. You can relay it to me. Is everybody else getting chat? The feed's still live, right? Okay, whatevs. You know, Yelp for me, it's helped a lot of people. Some people could see it as being a little detrimental. You know, you're giving a lot of power to people that don't necessarily have the credentials to wield it. You know, i.e. person down the street from me who had one bad experience at my wife's ramen place and then thinks that the entire establishment is bad forever. I don't know. Like I said, you're just giving a lot of power to people that I don't necessarily know have the authority to use it. Delivery services bug the heck out of me, especially ones that around my city put up ad campaigns that say, I'll cook when I'm dead, or don't go out to eat, you'll have to see more people. I think that those kinds of messages are very like detrimental to society and to food culture in general. I think that cooking is not New Jersey. I think cooking is awesome, and it's like, it's the best skill and like one of the best arts you could practice. So I'm not even gonna give those companies that use those kinds of ads like on the subway here in New York, I'm not even gonna give them the credit for saying their name. They also made this other like, not even vaguely racist ad that appeared recently, and I was so over it. If you check my Twitter feed, you can see my tirades. But this is a totally positive place, totally positive stream, so I'm not even gonna bother.
Warhood asks, do you believe in pre-soaking wood chips? Because that's normally how they're told to do it and to get more smoke when smoking meats.
You know,
or in this case, jackfruit.
Right? Barbecue, in general, is like the biggest can of worms, man. If you want to start a fight, you should actually do it. Go on to Reddit and go into a barbecue thread and just type something with a period, like, I soak my wood chips. And watch as you get ripped apart and defended. I've had this like realization later in life that like, I'm gonna do what works for me. Do I soak my wood chips? No, but what I do soak is I soak my wood chips, but I don't soak my wood chunks. So there you go. Is that game over? Oh my God! Oh my God! Tough to keep up, but man is this good. Homie, look at it. Dude, yours is wrapped better than mine.
Wow.
And look, there I am.
And that distribution is perfect.
Oh my God, this is like my mind is absolutely blown. I feel like we're inside of like the Matrix, or like, I don't know, what is that, Inception movie or something. Even your countertop looks like my countertop.
I'll make it the thumbnail.
Oh my goodness. That's insanity. Look at this. Oh my God. I feel like we're chefs and like people that work in food. Like,
they don't get to see this.
Yeah, when they don't get to see it, I don't even know that they get it done. Like, this is like mind altering. Look, I'm like I'm floored. I'm like totally floored.
I think that's awesome.
My Wi-Fi died for some reason, at least on this little guy. So I'm sorry. Look, Honey Badger, don't care. That's it. I actually, yeah, a lot of times I don't care. What I do care about is that people are actually cooking while you're making it, because that means that the total, like the goal of this, like mission accomplished, man, I can put the flight suit on and run for president and declare the job done. Shoot, now I gotta navigate to our own page. You guys didn't read my rider, did you?
Red Overlord says, what's the best way to cook a pizza?
Well, the best way to cook a pizza is in like a dedicated pizza oven, in my opinion, which most of us don't have. Justin Warner, shut up. Why are you interrupting me? I'm gonna pop out that chat and shut this guy up. So for me, having a dedicated oven is the way to the absolute best pizza. What I do though, I use a pizza stone, a pizza peel, and I use the hottest setting on my oven. If you wanted to build a wood fire oven outside, you're welcome to. I don't have the ways and means to do that. I think you can get a lot higher temperature of an oven. And for me, the hotter the oven is, the better the pizza, right?
Absolutely. And have you tried any cooking pizza on metal instead of the stone?
Like the baking steel?
The baking steel, or an upside down cast iron if you do smaller pizzas.
Oh no, I've never done that, but that seems like it's gonna be a chef shock waiting to happen. Are there still 1,000 people watching this? 1,300, this is like mind-blowing.
What are we cooking tomorrow?
We're gonna make, so tomorrow is Thrifty Thirst Day. There you go, thanks, you had to remind me. Thank you for giving me that lower third there. And so the concept for me behind Thrifty Thirst Day is that we're gonna save money, use some cheaper ingredients, and turn that money into a really great cocktail. Tomorrow we're gonna make kind of like a riff on Vietnamese pork chops, and we're gonna use crappy pork chops that, these aren't gonna be the big double bone bad boys that you see. We're gonna use the thin pork chops like mom used to make that can often be tough and like not full of flavor. We're gonna use those. We're also gonna use some sweet potatoes, also pretty cheap. We're gonna get some marshmallow fluff, which that's probably the most expensive thing, like ounce per ounce, that we're buying.
Yeah, because I mean, it doesn't weigh much, so yeah, absolutely.
Right. Yeah, and we're gonna make a sick marinade slash glaze on those pork chops, and we're gonna load up the potato with things like mandarin oranges. It's gonna be mind blowing. But canned mandarin oranges, like flavor bombs and absolutely cheap. What else are we gonna do? Oh yeah, and then we're gonna make the cocktail. And the cocktail for tomorrow is going to be a Sazerac, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, a Sazerac. And so the Sazerac is really great. You know, it's kind of weird. Twice in this week's streams, we'll be talking about anisette and anise. And I really think that anise is like one of those flavors that once you really start cooking and you really start getting into food, and you learn how to appreciate that sort of, thanks for following, that wild licorice flavor. Once you get hooked, it's like, that's like taking the blue pill. You know, you're just like on the other side of the coin.
I feel like it's something people have to get into. I know that fennel and anise and licorice things can be very polarizing, but I think it's kind of like once you learn to start having it, you love it.
And I think it's really, you have to have it served to you by someone with a judicious hand. I think we've all been given licorice as a kid, you know, by some like twisted uncle who's like, you're gonna hate this, boy. Or maybe that's just my own life.
No, it happened to me.
All right.
Yeah, yeah. But I mean, I loved it. I even loved that Scandinavian salted licorice.
Oh, man. I had a friend bring me that. That stuff is insane.
So intense.
Right?
It's great. Just a little goes a long, so long way. Yep, absolutely.
I feel like the Gobstopper was like made by that. You know, like informed by salted licorice.
I would say it would be between that and the Good and Plenty's.
Yeah, totally. Good and Plenty's. Does anybody eat those? Oh, Ben's back there. Ben is back there. Just like, that's the biggest negative I've ever seen from Ben. Cut to Ben. Ben, just repeat that. Do you mind? You don't have to get him in focus, that's all right.
Yeah, Ben is actually one of the chat room celebrities.
Really?
Oh yeah.
Great, thanks guys. It means I can't fire him if he screws up. just kidding. Ben employs me, actually.
And since we made the bechamel earlier, Audioslave 212 was saying, how can I make an Alfredo sauce especially good? Like any secret ingredients, it's my favorite sauce.
Yeah, Alfredo sauce. If you really want to make your Alfredo sauce like go, like restaurant quality, you gotta understand this little thing called nutmeg. Nutmeg in almost anything creamy, I don't know why, but it like turns it into a new beast, a new animal.
It's similar to that clove and banana thing where it's like the same molecules that's kind of found in butter.
Yeah, it's just how it works. You know, one of the heaviest, hardest hitting Alfredo recipes that I've ever made is Giada's. I mean, thank you for cheering, Astronat. Gotta give Giada a shout. She's actually been one of the coolest people in the Food Network family. I was hanging out in Miami, tough life, wearing yellow linen. And I heard someone be like, oh my God, Justin. And I was like, you know, prepared for like, I don't know, cool, I'll sign your cookbook. You know, hey, thank you. Maybe your friends from Twitter and now Twitch. And it was freaking Giada, you know? And like Giada doesn't have to like take time out of her day to like go say hey to Justin. I'm like, sweet Alfredo. Yeah, Alfredo's. Dope.
The Kokiri Swordsman says, when can we make some eggnog? And I want to know, do you do the like the AB aged eggnog? Because I actually just made that today.
Ooh, wow, Kelsey's for ahead of Christmas. The game.
Well, you got to keep like 2 months.
Uh-huh. I don't know. Is there any time we shouldn't be making nog? I don't know. Maybe it's just like a run of the show thing. Ben, are you going to eat my mac and cheese?
Definitely.
Really? What about the greens?
Oh, hell no.
Greens aren't going to happen. What about the jackfruit? You've never had it, so how can you even have an opinion?
Therefore, I hate it.
Oh.
See, I always think I taught kids cooking and I said, you don't have to like it, but you gotta try it and you gotta just tell me what you don't like about it. Because then we'll learn your taste. If you don't like bitter things or you don't like sour
don't like
things.
Ben doesn't like anything. All right. Ben was photoshopped. Ben is not real. I wish. I'm just kidding, Ben. I'm just kidding. I love you to death, dude. You do a great job back there. How much salt should I use in the water when making pasta? They say that it should be like the sea. So what I would do for you, and there's really no right answer to this, I would add the salt while the water is cold, give it a stir, take a tiny, teeny like finger dip, and if it feels like you're at the beach, well, there you go. If you've not been to the beach, well, you should fix that before you even start making pasta. Just go to the beach.
Double Sleeping Bag Fun says, do you make mince pies around Christmas? And I'm wondering, do you like getting into like the holiday cooking and...
You know, when I was growing up, my mother never made traditional holiday food. Which is, you know, that's kind of a cool question. She always, like, one year we just straight up had Chinese food for Thanksgiving. And I believe, and maybe I'm gonna really ruffle some feathers here. I just threw that away to make a point, not because I'm done. But, you know, we live in a very, like, you gotta argue, maybe it's argumentative right now, or arguable rather right now, but we live in a pretty cool country that, like, is not gonna arrest us if we don't serve, like, this state-mandated Thanksgiving or Christmas dinner. And so, like, I love getting my friends together. I'm kind of like an orphan when I'm not hanging out in, like, my family in South Dakota. That's where my wife's fam lives. We like to get together, and we go to a place called Kanji Village, and we get a big Lazy Susan, and we eat all this, like, wacky Chinese food. I love that, and that's kind of just, like, what I grew up with. So, it depends on the audience, you know? If you were to, say, call my agent and get me to, like, you know, cater your Scrooge McDuck Christmas, or Hanukkah, or whatever, or Kwanzaa, or Jewish Kwanzaa, like the subscriber that we have here. I would just do whatever you want, you know what I mean? If you want to crown rack a lamb for Christmas, which I think is a great thing to do for Christmas, super celebratory, right?
Absolutely.
If you want turkey on Thanksgiving, okay. I'm not the biggest, like, proponent of consuming the entire bird, turkey. I'd rather just get a portion of it and eat that, but, you know, that doesn't give you that classic, like, Instagrammable Thanksgiving image.
No, but a smoked turkey leg works as well.
Smoked turkey legs, like we're at the Ren Fair.
Exactly, or, you know, Epcot, because.
Right.
I might be nerdy, but I'm not Ren Fair nerdy.
Oh really? Shucks. I might be. Whoops. Crazy. I grew up in Maryland and visit my grandparents in South Dakota every summer. Foo-one-ish. Yeah. We got a lot in common, apparently. South Dakota's a great place. People knock it, you know? It's always ending up on, like, BuzzFeed's list of least, like, foodie states or whatever. And, you know, it's like, just because they don't make a lot of racket over there, like in South Dakota, seriously, these people are humble. They work, they come home, they take care of their families, they relax, and they make good food, and they chill. And, like, that's it, man. Like, they just don't make racket, you know? Like, I feel like it's always New York, Florida, and California just, like, always making noise.
I feel like Florida is in the news for more things than food more often. And yeah, the food, I mean, the food city is a different one every year. Who knows? They might get their time. Yuki GG is saying, do you have any plans to use liquid nitrogen any times?
I don't know, maybe. I like to use liquid nitrogen when I don't have to pay for it, like when I'm on a competitive show or something. I've never really felt the need to do it. I mean, I know how, but you know, I think I'd rather just, like, churn my ice cream and make it and show you, like, a practical way to do it as opposed to keeping, like, when you have liquid nitrogen, you have to have a doer, which is, like, hundreds of dollars in itself. You have to have the liquid nitrogen itself. You should really have protective gloves. You should have goggles. You should have a stand mixer. And so while it is very cool and very social media friendly to make ice cream with liquid nitrogen, if you like spending $1,000 for a quart of ice cream, be my guest, bro. You know, like, amazing. I'm gonna put it in this, look at this gray box over here. You can cut, that's fine. Yeah, like, you just, over here. This is my little gray box thing. I inherited this. I got this from this gal named Jen Solomon. Huh? Dabs! Thank you for keeping the lights on. Maybe we'll get ourselves some liquid nitrogen. Who knows? this little guy, he's got a couple problems with him. You know, he's kind of an orphan at this point, but, let me tell you, it still works. It still makes quality ice cream, one quart at a time. And I bought that used for like $100 or something like that. It's really heavy, but other than that, that's what I use to make ice cream. Great question, thank you.
And Kimothy3 said, what makes the mustard powder such a game changer for the mac and cheese?
You know, for me, it all comes down to sulfur, and that's a really good question. Sulfur is in cheese, and like sulfur is in mustard, and it's what gives you that, like, oh, it's sharp cheese. If you look at like the German word for sharp, they use sharp. I think it's scharf. They use scharf to describe ketchup that bites you, or mustard. We say hot mustard, but it's not actually hot. It doesn't burn your tongue.
Right. It's a different type. It's like the wasabi heat.
Yeah, it gets you in your sinus.
And exactly.
It's not a capsicum. It's not a ghost pepper sort of heat. It's not burning your tongue.
No.
It burns you up here. And that's because you're getting, I think it's actually just like a sulfur reaction. Am I crazy?
No, you're absolutely right. That's exactly what it is. And I think that the word comes from actually a German origin.
All right.
So that's where we get that. And also, that last, keeping the lights on, that was Gobbledygooks, not Anonymous.
Oh. Mm-hmm. I don't know why that didn't show up. Gobbledygooks. Thank you. And thank you also for cheering, Mermaid Girl. It's really amazing that people like this and want to support this. I'm flabbergasted. I can't believe someone actually made tonight's food and cooked along. You know what's really hilarious? I think like the number of, hey, well, Exotic Larry, if you're in Germany, like, am I right? Don't you like call like mustard and ketchup scharf? We'll find out. But you know, the vast majority of people that watch traditional food television never, ever, ever end up cooking. And so it's really crazy that like already we've kind of like disrupted this entire medium and hence giving credit to the name ChefShock. One more question, let's wrap it up, because I want to refill this glass.
All right, do you prefer, Jawa Racin says, do you prefer clementines, tangerines, mandarin oranges, or blood oranges, or plain oranges?
I think I'm going to go with the satsuma. I've had one satsuma in my life. You ever seen one?
Yeah.
It's kind of like in the tangerine
I
family.
I went down to New Orleans, and I...
Is it the same as the tangerine?
It's similar, but I actually thought it was really mild. I didn't get much out of it.
Really? You know, there's something for me, it's like I don't,
Ooh, and Gobbledygooks made the meatloaf Monday and said it was good.
Thank you, Gobbledygooks. I don't know, there's something for me, orange is like my least favorite of all citrus fruits. Like, I can appreciate its time and place. But I think the fact that we've all grown up with orange juice, like, it's like the number one consumed citrus day in and day out. It's just like boring. I've just like heard that tune, you know?
All right.
So I like to go for like very like alternative weird. If I have to pick a citrus fruit of all time, it's freaking yuzu. Yuzu, and we haven't even used that or even touched on that on Chef Shock. Yuzu is like the best. All right, one more question and that's it because we're way over our allotted time frame and we don't pay overtime on Chef Shock.
Theoretical Sandwiches wants to know, would soup dumplings be too much to make on this show sometime?
My concern with soup dumplings and this show is that if you've watched it, I always go from raw ingredients to finished dish in the allotted amount of time. I don't know that I would be able to chill the soupy part of the soup dumpling fast enough in order for it to gelatinize to put in the dumpling.
Have you ever had the soup dumplings that are just made by adding extra fatty meat in your soup is really just meat juices and fat that's leaked out?
Tired. Kelsey Kinzer, everybody, hired. Maybe I will, you know, I don't know. I just feel like if I was gonna do it, I'd wanna do it like the long form way.
Right.
Right?
No, that's how I'd heard the, what is it, Joe's or Ginger's down in Chinatown.
Really?
That they just have super fatty meat and that's kind of their quick hack.
Okay, dope, maybe we will. Maybe we will make soup dumplings. And I think, make Aspic ahead of time, Ghost Override, you've obviously read my playbook, dude. Because yeah, I'm an Aspic fanatic. Thank you all so much for tuning in to another fine episode of Chef Shock. We'll be back tomorrow for Thrifty Thirst Day, and we'll be making some pork chops and cocktails and a loaded sweet potato that's going to blow your brains. Thank you for everybody for tuning in. This is incredible. I always just feel completely overjoyed at this point. Thanks to everybody who's been subscribing. Thanks for all you Gold Pan members, and thanks for the donations, keeping the lights on. But yeah, I think I'm gonna sip this and stop being live. Have a great night, gang.
Have a great night.
Oh, that was good.